You're on the tooth, hungry for more, as the nation dumps here on 7.
In Tasmania, a popular seat named after the fish, where Michelle O'Byrne is the sitting member for the Labor Party. Bit of a game there, and the local member, the challenger in the main, Tony Bennyworth, the well-known cricketer, he could really bring it back from outside the off stump. He's losing vote there to the expense of both the Democrats and Greens. And let's have a look at the two-party preferred with 70% counted.
I'd say Michelle O'Byrne's back here, HG.
Indeed. You're counting that as a Labor
seat? I'm taking that as a seat held for the ALP.
Well, let's find out how Michelle's done it with Chris right now.
Michelle O'Byrne, Roy and HG have you scraping back in, but it's not over yet. Only 70% of the vote counted, and of course in 1998 you only won by 78 votes. Do you think it's going to come down to the wire again and be that close?
I don't think that when you're in Bass you can ever get too comfortable on the night. It took about 12 days to find out last time. I'd like to know tonight, my volunteers would like to know tonight, and it's really nice that Roy thinks we're in there.
So how much chance do you give yourself of winning the seat this evening and getting a result this evening?
We'd like to have the result this evening. It's particularly cool. We're feeling very buoyed by the results so far, but there are a couple of major booths still to come in. We'll hold out till we see them before we start dancing in the aisles.
So Green preferences are going to be fairly crucial to you, but it's operating on a split ticket in Bass, as I understand it.
The Greens didn't preference here last election. They haven't again this year. They tend to go Green Democrat and then it's open. Traditionally, we tend to pick up a few, but they seem to be going all over the place at the moment. I will wait and see at the end of the night just how well we've done out of them.
Michelle O'Byrne, Glenn Milne here. The Ansett collapse.
Hi, Glenn.
Hi, how are you?
Obvious ones.
And Dixon's gone for Cheryl Kernow, you think?
Well, she wasn't looking too good early, but was still in early votes if we've got to figure now. But
no, I'd say Dixon's still in with a very good show of winning. It's showing a 2% swing to the Liberals with a quarter of the vote counted, Glenn. So I'd say Cheryl's very much in there with a serious show. Everybody's written her off, but I think Dixon's going to be a tight battle.
Cheryl Kernow back as a minister.
Yes, the problem being for Dixon, though, I don't think any of the preferences will be flowing through to Cheryl Kernow. Michelle O'Byrne, whom we saw a moment ago, Lindsay Tanner, what's the future for her? I know you'd issue position her in question time, so she's always on screen. Does that mean down the track she's going to have a future with the party or what?
Possibly on the front bench, closer to the screen might actually improve things even further.
Positioning like that, is that accidental or do you place people specifically?
Oh, look, I think you'd need to speak to our whip, Leo McClay, who's in charge of these things. We all just take orders. I've got a spot that's very close to the speaker, which means I get into trouble all the time. But
what about on your
Leo's
side
call
of the house, Peter? Well,
they put Michelle there because that's the only time she gets any coverage.
Well, you put Gary Neal.
Looks like she's holding her seat
Gary
with
Nan,
an increased majority, so she must have got some coverage from somewhere.
I got no idea
you put
why they sit where
behind.
I got no idea why they sit where they sit. I used to just sit behind the PM because I'd like to know what's going
on. Well, you're on the front bench. We're talking about. Well, I know that, but people behind you.
The great thing about Gary Nan is he's always listening to the races in the seat, and I think, bloody hell, something must be coming in from Cessnock or Scone.
But it always looks
like
he's losing, too. He's just done his shirt.
That's right.
Look, we've got a national share of the vote figure, and we will be looking at Queensland soon, so if you're in Queensland, we'll be coming to you soon. Let's go to the national share of the vote now. Roy?
Yes, we've got Labor on 39.1%, HG. Liberal 36.9%. Democrats 5.5, as you can see there. So if we run that, can we run that to a two-party preferred?
With 50% of the total vote counted.
And that will give us a bit of an idea.
We can't go to that two-party preferred. So at the moment,
but
the swing...
But I think the ALP had to get, a bit more than 39.1%.
Indeed, the swing to the government on those figures with half the vote counted is 2.7%.
Yes.
2.7%. And the Labor, it's coming at the expense of Labor and others, including One Nation.
One Nation, yes.
Which is obviously the vote's gone all over the place there, but a lot of it back to the coalition.
Yeah.
And the coalition gain, as we see there, is 2.7. I may have said that. Look, it's the national dump. The nation's dumped, and we're just counting it here on Channel 7. Back with more right after this. Living up to your earlier predictions when you were just a brigadier?
Yes, it's almost exactly what I was saying before. The government will win the election with a very slightly increased majority in terms of seats. Yes. The two-party preferred vote swing, I think, to the government will finish up at about 1.5%. the Liberal Party's first preference vote is up substantially, but don't forget that the reason for that is the collapse of the One Nation vote.
Yes.
And the Labour first preference vote appears probably to be down, but that's going to the Greens and Democrats, which will then go back to the Labour Party. I think the reason why Labour's tally in seats will be reasonably good, almost comparable with last time, is that Labour has been a bit luckier this time. Last time the coalition was extremely lucky in the marginal seats. This time it looks as though Labour has a bit more luck, which means that it won't be a particularly bad defeat for them. The other point I should make is that the three independents are clearly now Kennedy, Mr. Catter, Collaire, Mr. Andren, and New England, where Stuart Sinclair looks as though he's lost the seat to the independent Tony Windsor. So those are three losses, effectively. The other point I would make is that I'm sure the Green Senator Bob Brown has been re-elected in Tasmania.
Thanks very much, Major General. Now, Major General, you often knock out a monograph on an election. I think your first one was on the donkey vote way back in 1962. Can you see yourself getting a book out of this election?
Oh, I intend to write an interesting analysis of all the details of the election, but I think the major thing that's interesting is that probably the coalition will have a majority of the two-party preferred vote this time, whereas last time it was 51-49 for Labour. My guess is that the two-party preferred will finish up at about 50.2 for the coalition, 49.8 for Labour, which is not a particularly bad result for Labour in actual fact. I mean, bearing in mind the way the appearance of the first preference Liberal rise creates a much better impression for the government than is actually the case.
Yes, thanks very much for that, Major General, and good luck with that promotion.
Very
I know you're going for
thoughts.
Yeah. Now we move on to more seats in the first for the night from Queensland. Cheryl Curnow, the sitting member in Dixon. We've got a bludger rating for Cheryl. Here she is on screen now, yep. Whipping them into a storm of frenzy. And the bludger rating, Roy?
47 from memory, I think, HG. 47. So just on the right side of doing some work.
Now let's have a look at the seat then. The seat is Dixon.
Yep.
This is a troublesome seat for the Labor Party tonight, but... And it looks as though on those figures that Cheryl has lost a fair bit of vote.
She certainly has, HG.
Let's go to the two-party preferred, which will tell the tale. And let's have a look here. And that, to me, after only 29% counted, does look as though it's a bit wobbly.
I think she's in trouble, HG, because a lot of the preferences aren't going towards her.
Now,
the Democrats specifically, I think, put their preferences elsewhere.
And then we move on to Ryan. Ryan, that controversial seat, I think, held for many years by John Moore, who, when he was couldn't fire the bullets anymore, he said, I'm off. And then there was that by-election that returned the Labor personality in Short, Leonie Short, from memory.
Yep.
Obviously, the seat's going to go back to the Liberal Party,
Roy. Looks like it, HG. Yes, Johnson here with a significant increase. They're 67-33, so you'd have to say that's a safe win.
Only a tiny percentage counted, but
sure.
Nonetheless, I would expect that to go
you
back to the Liberal.
You extrapolate from that, I think, HG, a bit of a win there.
Have you extrapolated
I'm
that to Liberal? Yes, good. Now we move on to Herbert. Herbert, one of my favourite seats. Herbert. And Herbert,
named after the playwright Bob Herbert.
That's right, after Bob Herbert.
Yep.
And there's many other interesting figures in Queensland. Now, 33% of the seat is counted. We've got Peter Lindsay there, with the Liberal bit of a gain there. The ALP hasn't lost much vote, but a bit going to the Greens and Democrats, One Nation well off the pace.
Yep.
Now, what are you making of that, Roy, on the two-party preferred?
Well, I think you'd have to say... Gee, it's going to be too close to call, I think, at this stage, HG. Let's have a look at the two-party preferred if we could.
33% counted. Here we go. Let's have a look at it here.
Yep, 52-48. Well, I think with 33% counted, that is too close to call at this stage. But it's interesting that One Nation is disappearing, isn't it?
As an electoral force.
One imagines that they've gone to the government. Welcome home.
Morton now. Morton with an interesting... this has got Gary Hargrave there.
Yep.
Gary Hargrave has held for the Libs since 1996, from memory, and he's increased his vote there, so even if we go to the two-party preferred, it'll show, hopefully, a Liberal win by a fairly substantial majority, 10%.
Yep.
Now, we move on to Hinkler, where Paulie Neville's got the seat, and Paul Neville for the National Party. Let's have a look at his bludger rating, Roy.
Yes, there he is there. Theatre manager in a past life, HG. Also, I said on the Bundaberg Tourism Board, bludger rating of 36, or is that 39?
39, I think.
Hasn't done too badly at all. He's on the right
end. That whole ensemble's looking really good for the bloke. I love a pink suit with a pink shirt.
So, well, I've noticed. And so, looking at
Hinkler.
The specific... Hinkler. Here
what's happening here? We've got an increase in the vote in the National Party.
Yep.
We've got a decrease of the Labor vote, going to two-party preferred. preferred.
Yeah, I think
that's
too close to call, but I think it might be towards the ALP. No, it's not. It's towards Neville.
But, you know, extrapolate, Roy. Do a bit of extrapolation.
I'm extrapolating, and I'm thinking that's going to go to the government.
Oh, righto, to the National Party there. Yep. Incidentally, it'll be interesting to work with Malcolm McKerris when he gets that promotion to Field Marshal to see what's happened to the National Party vote overall.
To see if John Anderson has increased the National Party, yes.
And we go to Longman. Longman, where Mal Brough, who I think we can see on screen right now.
There he is.
The bludger rating coming up for Bruffy.
I think he's in the 70s, actually. I think he's a real bludger. Let's have a look here.
71. Yeah,
71, done nothing.
However,
he
burst back into prominence late in this recent parliamentary session or parliamentary term and was given a bit of an elevation into the ministry. Now, we've got the seat here, which is obviously a big increase in his vote.
Yeah, Steve Beckett's
Labor
running against him.
At the expense of
the former
One
car
Nation
salesman, yes. Let's have a look here. One Nation down, as predicted. We look at the two party, you'd have to say probably the Brough is back.
The Brough's back in business.
Yep.
And Chris, I think you might have Mal on the mojo wire.
Yes, I do. The Employment Services Minister joins me now. Mr. Brough, those GST...
Good leadership, it's what it's all about. John Howard's got to be there for the duration, the war, the boat people. He's going to get the shock of his life when he leaves, when Howard's off, and there's Bruffy up there trying to explain to those people who have put that bloke back into Canberra what's happened to Howard. I mean, there's going to be a lot of therapy needed up there. Have you factored that into the budget?
Mate, I wouldn't bet on Howard going. I mean, you seem to be betting on
it. Can you give us a guarantee here tonight, break some news, Howard's here for the duration and the next election as well?
Well, look, you win three elections in a row, you're a pretty popular bloke, I tell you.
I think you'd have to dynamite.
And especially with marginal seat people, I mean, three elections in a row when a whole lot of people say shocking things about him.
Yeah. I have no doubt about that
at
all.
And he doesn't give a damn. He hangs on in there. He's a damn fighter.
What about these elites?
People like that. They like a fighter, you know.
He's staying. He's staying?
Well, you'd have to ask him that.
Look, it's Roy and HG here. It's not Glenn Mills. It's not Kerry O'Brien. It's Ray. It's a couple of Batman buffheads here trying to get a straight answer from a politician. Is he in for the duration or out?
He's a strong leader and a
bow
and he's ready.
Let's go to the break now. The band are coming back with that answer after the break on the next one.
It excites people's interest. Prime Minister doing up shoes. Good heavens. Hello, I'll call you back.
You're on the tooth, hungry for more, as the nation dumps here on Seven.
Yes.
Yes, welcome back to the National Tally Room. Things are getting exciting and, look, let's try and go to the bums on seats. Now, this is the dump team prediction of how this election is going to turn out. As you can see, the target down the bottom there is 76. And maybe we can't go to that because we have a mechanical to do here.
I think we're going to say goodbye to Western Australia.
We do.
I think they're going to have a news service. And they have one of the best news services in the world, don't they?
News service.
I don't know much about it, from what I hear, it's very good.
And so from the National Tally Room, we say farewell, WA. Enjoy the news.
Their news services is one of the worst in the world.
It is, isn't it?
It's so bloody hopeful.
It is easy to bag it, isn't it?
I mean, God almighty. It's a con. It's a con.
And
speaking of cons, we were engaged here a moment ago with Senator Vanstone about the Prime Minister's intentions.
Now,
he's going to stay and stay and stay, and the plotters are going to have to get out. I mean, Costello's going to have to get a plot together to get rid of him, isn't he?
Look, I think he'll go at a time of his choosing.
Yes. They never go at a time of their own choosing.
Name someone
who has.
Some Menzies. Do. Menzies. There you are.
And
good on you,
mate. The Prime Minister sees himself as a Menzies-like figure, doesn't he?
Well, Menzies is a Liberal Party hero.
Yes.
Look, let me make the point. We've got three ministers retiring. Peter Reith and Fay and Woolley.
Mm.
Now, some people say, oh, well, look, they're deserting the government.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if they'd waited until after the election to retire, everyone would say, oh, that stinks, doesn't it?
No, that's
fancy
true.
Getting re-elected, you have a by-election. People want honesty, they say they want it, and then when they get it, they don't always want it. Now, what's the Prime Minister said? He's been perfectly honest with the electorate and said, when I'm 64, I'm not going to sing the Beatles song because I'm no good at it, I'm going to consider my position. He's being honest with the electorate, and that shocks some people.
No,
they're not used to having someone who directly says, I'm going to think about it.
Well, I don't think so.
Roy thinks he changed his mind after he said the 64.
He's changed his mind. I think he'll be there. If he could stay until he was 90,
he would. He's won three elections in a row, I tell you. You know, he'd have to be pretty popular.
Speaking of a bum on a seat, let's have a look at the Bums on Seats, and this is the Dump team prediction of how the new house will look. Brigadier McCarris is plugged in as he's risen up through the ranks. He's now Field Marshal McCarris. He's put in. The Dump computers are put in. Let's have a look at it, Roy.
Well, it looks as if it's pretty close to unchanged, actually. You've got to remember there are two extra electorates now in the composition of this new parliament. So we have the coalition with 80, Labour with 67, and others, that is the independents, on 3. So it's a pretty comfortable working majority, we anticipate, for the government.
And most of those independents, you'd have to say, it'd surprise anybody if they voted with Labour, wouldn't you? I don't know, we might ask Glenn later on.
Well, it wouldn't matter. They don't...
I know. They can't... Yes, they can't affect the vote.
They have no authority.
OK, we move on to Paterson. Paterson, the two bob watch seat. And have a look quickly there, the sitting member.
Two bobs, yes.
Well, 76% counted. Let's go to the two-party preferred. And it would show, I think, that the Labor Party will hold that with a slight swing on my computer.
No, the other way around, I think, AC. I think that could go to
Yes, on distribution.
I think Big Bob Horn is in trouble.
Yes, one of the bobs is in trouble there.
One of the bobs.
Sorry,
Bob Horn's in trouble. Okay.
Moving on to Hunter, where Joel Fitzgibbon is the sitting member. And let's have a look at his bludger rating.
Yeah, he looks good, doesn't he, AC? Nice hair, nice part down the middle. And his bludger rating is 31, so he's done more than many.
And let's have a look at his seat now, the figures there.
Yeah,
Another Bob up against him, Bob McCauley for the National Party.
Yep.
And have a look here.
I think the fishing party were putting someone in here as well.
Look. I had to interrupt you there.
Yes, Chris, that's all right. Yes.
Peter Costello was keeping a rather low profile in Melbourne.
Yes,
he's going across there right now because he's emerged.
Off you go.
That, we've not only won the seat of Higgins, but we've had a swing to us. A swing to us, and it is as a result of the wonderfully hard work that each and every one of you have done here. I want to pay particular tribute to Andrea, who has been the most fantastic campaign manager. She is just magnificent, and thank you all very, very much. To Helen Maxwell-Wright, our campaign chairman, you are our electorate chairman, 39 out of 39 booths today, and that was fabulous. To Angela, who did all of the polling, and if you think that she's on your hammer, she is, because it's so important, which is really fabulous, and I want to thank you for all of the people that stood out there today and who worked so wonderfully hard. You were magnificent, and this has been a great victory. A very, very large swing against the Labor Party. Yeah. Which has been fabulous as well. You're all part of our family. You've just been magnificent today on all of the booths. I see all of our workers that are here. It's your victory. We had to work hard to win the trust of the people of Higgins and to make sure that we were on the hammer of the issues that counted in this area. And we were. We didn't take any step for granted. We didn't leave any stone unturned. We didn't leave any issue unfought. We didn't leave any voter unloved. And I want to thank the people of Higgins for giving me the honour of representing them again. I can pledge to them as their local member that there will be no let up at all in the service that we give to all of the people who are here in our electorate. Most of all, I want to thank Tanya, my wife, who's been fantastic. The children, who've had to put up with quite a bit during this campaign. Sebastian and Madeline and Phoebe, and they've had some incredible pressure now.
Peter Costello, claiming victory, and
thought that through.
He thought it through. What I liked about that clip there was I thought I was in Britain. You saw the Union Jack draped behind there.
Yes.
You didn't see any Australia. Look, there it is there. You're in Britain. He's in a seat
somewhere in the
West Country in Britain.
No
Australian bunting up at all.
He's talking about a big swing towards you know, away from the ALP here.
Yeah, towards him.
And yet the swing in Higgins is away from him by 2.2%.
Is that right? Can we confirm that, Amanda Vanstone?
Well, that's what we've, is that
well,
right, Amanda Vanstone?
The two-party preferred looks like a small swing there at the moment. But, you
away
know,
from Peter Costello.
But when you're the treasurer, I mean...
You can make up figures, well, you can do whatever you like with bloody figures.
And let's not forget...
You're going to make hard decisions
about gilding the bloody lily, that is
madness.
You're
going to make hard decisions when you're the treasurer.
And let's not forget, Peter Costello thinks that conscription saved us in World War II.
World War II!
Brilliant idea. The man who will be leader. Yes, a beautiful grasp there. Obviously, the Bunning, he thinks he's in England. Conscription there saved them in World War II. Now we move on to Mayo. Mayo, where Alexander Downer, we've got a bit of a bludger rating for the bloke.
Oh, yes, there he is.
Here he comes now up. What's his bludger rating, Roy? I've got 16. What have you
got? Yeah, I've got 16 as well. So okay. He's done more than many.
We go to the seat of Mayo, and I think that this should be obviously a fairly... Remember, he got a big challenge from a Democrat in that seat. Might have been John Schumann last time.
That's right.
And we can't bring any figures. We'll just get the binoculars onto the board here.
71% counted, yet
and,
nothing here.
Downer with a bit of a swing on about
14%. He's gone up by nearly 7%.
Off the board.
Yeah.
7%. So a lot of that was the collapse of the Schumann vote. And I think Chris...
Two-party preferred is going to be very comfortable for...
Let's have a quick look at the two-party preferred. 64-36. Chris...
Alexander Downer is joining us now from Mayo. Mr. Downer, you must be fairly happy about the swing towards you.
Yes, it's a pretty substantial swing and I'm very happy about it. I've worked in the electorate very hard over the last 3 years and obviously I very much appreciate the local people giving me as a local person born and raised in the electorate such good support this time.
Do you also attribute some of that though to the absence of John Schumann this time around?
Well, I think as a candidate, he would have done better than the candidate the Democrats did run this time. But I think the Democrats have really sort of run into a lot of trouble. They, giving preferences to the Labor Party, found that in some seats, found that that reduced their credibility somewhat. And the old traditional position of the Democrats being the party somewhat in the middle, it rather looked like a somewhat left-wing party. So I don't think it went down terribly well in the electorate of Mayo.
Alexander Downer, Glenn Milne here. Well, that's quite surprising too, because that whole hills area that you you hold up there is very much a Chardonnay and small acreage area now, isn't it?
Well, we produce Chardonnay, if that's what you mean.
And drink a bit too, I think.
Yeah, you're quite... well, a little. Tonight we are drinking rather a lot, I'd have to confess, although I haven't personally started yet. But, no, it's an area where the Democrats have occasionally done very well. For example, in 1990, they got about 21%. In 1998, they got 22%. But their vote goes up and down quite dramatically. It's depends very much on the candidates they run and the broader issues. And I think, to some extent, what we've learned in the Adelaide Hills is that as Liberals, we can take nothing for granted. We've got to put in very strong campaigns, and when we do that, state and federal, we can get good results. But in the Adelaide Hills, people don't want to be taken for granted, and that's fair enough.
Alexander Downer, how much damage to the Democrats do you think was done by John Coulter, the former leader, who withdrew support for Natasha Stott-Despoja just in the last days of the campaign?
No, I don't think that had a lot of effect. It had a bit of an effect in Mayo because he lives in Mayo, and it was broken by the local newspaper, the Mount Barker Courier, on their front page on Wednesday morning. So it would have done them some harm in Mayo. But overall in the country, I think the biggest single mistake that the Democrats made was doing the preferences deal with the Labor Party. And whenever they've done these deals in the past, it's been bad for them, and it's been bad for them at this election. And if I were running the Democrats, which is a very improbable proposition, but I'd never do preference deals. I'd always try to present the Democrats as a middle-of-the-road party, like the British Liberal Democrats. But they've sort of become the fourth faction of the Labor Party and out on the left of the Labor Party. And yeah, it's such a small constituency for them. I think they've done very badly overall in terms of their performance.
Mr. Downer, we've got Amanda Vanstone here, your fellow South Australian. She's being very coy under pressure from Roy and ASG, immense pressure, I might say. can you tell us what you think about the ultimate outcome here tonight? Do you think you've been returned to government?
Well, obviously, the signs are very promising at the moment. I don't think any of us are in a position where we quite want to call the result. It's... I personally don't know anything about Western Australia. I think the polling booths there are probably just closed. But overall, their sitting members have tended to have held their seats. We've clearly done pretty well in New South Wales, particularly in and around Sydney, and picked up seats there, which has been important. And in Queensland, it's quite a strong result as well.
Mr. Downer, we'll have to leave
Victoria.
Sorry, we'll have to leave it there, Mr. Downer. Thank you very much for your time tonight. Steve Martin, you're looking and feeling a little glum here to my left.
Well, I've just had a look again at the Adelaide seat, and I wouldn't necessarily write that off for us yet. But certainly, if you look around South Australia, the news is not all that flash for us. I think clearly people have disaggregated national and state issues in that state, because we had a premier resign in the middle of the campaign and all sorts of suggestions of scandals in the Liberal Party at the state level, but that hasn't translated, it would seem, at least at the national level. And I guess people are smart enough these days to distinguish between different levels of government.
Lindsay Tanner, your colleague, was here. I was speaking to him a few moments ago. He was saying he thinks it's a status quo election. Is that your view?
It certainly looks that way, with possibly a couple of changes of seats, but basically status quo.
Yeah,
opposition changing over, and a couple of government seats being lost to us and so on. But it looks at this stage as if it's status quo, and it's disappointing from our perspective.
I don't know whether we can pull up the seat of Dobell, your factional colleague there, Michael Lee. That's a bit of a shock, isn't it? I mean, he was going to be a cabinet minister. He was education spokesman, and I mean, he's just done really poorly, hasn't he?
Well, look, the redistribution wasn't kind to Michael. The last election, he got over 3%, but it had been pared back. And the fact of the matter is, I mean, it is a high mortgage belt area.
There it is. We've got it up there now, Stephen Martin, you can see.
It's a high mortgage belt area. It's got a high aged population as well.
Well, I would have thought that would have favoured you, though, because you ran very hard on aged care.
We did indeed, and we ran very hard on education and the issues that I thought were important. But what we can see there is that the Liberal Party candidate, who I understand wouldn't even speak to the media, has been able to, at this stage at least, seems to have been successful. Now, it's too close to call. Michael, as I said earlier, is a great campaigner. I scrutinised for him in 1996 when he got in by 141 votes. It may well come down that again. I can see a few trips up the freeway to Wyong coming up.
They are Roy and HG. Michael Lee,
could we look at Dobell, two-party preferred, just to see how close that is? I know it's too close to call, so it's going to be roughly around 50% each one would imagine. No, we're not going to get that.
No.
Oh, here we are.
Well, let's just move that across to the on-air. Now, look, when I was a kid and we started calling elections just after the war, what would often happen is the Labor Party vote would come in early. As we've got older and more mature, what tends to happen is the Liberal Party vote comes in early. Is that a fair assessment of what's going on tonight, or do you think this is a two-party preferred?
Yeah, it's 50% each. Yeah,
do you think it's fairly to say that it's a much more even count these days?
I think it is fairly even. That one especially is, you know, too close, 50-50.
Yes.
And interestingly, 74% of the seat counted.
Yes.
So, and we've got no idea what's going to happen.
Yes.
But it hasn't been good for Michael Lee.
Lee,
he's had a fairly considerable swing against him and a big swing to the Liberals.
Now, what do we know about this?
They're not happy down there, we know that much.
No, what do we know about this Ticehurst bloke? What's the story, Senator? What do we know about him?
No, look, I've never met Ken, so I can't give you a sort of personal...
Can you see a cabinet berth for Ken? I mean, Minister of Defence is vacant.
New members are pretty lucky to do that, aren't they?
Yeah. No. We live in interesting times. We've got Howard committing for the next three elections, courtesy of you. We've got Kenny Ticehurst coming in to fill the vacant chair left by Rocket Reef. And we've got also the Minister of Health to fill, and I'm seeing a new name coming in there too. I'll reveal that later on tonight.
Well, no, the issue about Ken is that Ken won't talk to the press, so it's pretty hard for anyone to get to know Ken. I thought you might have been able to tell us something about him.
Well, I think one of the interesting points is the point that was made, that he hasn't had a high media profile.
No.
And still...
And didn't seek one.
Still he's got a swing. Now, what does that tell you? That the vote is not for the candidate, but against the sitting member and for the government.
Sure.
That the candidate in this sense doesn't matter.
No,
they are unhappy.
You could have run a driver's door.
Can I just say about Ken, the only thing I know about him is he tracks storms from Tumbiumbi.
Yes, lightning storms.
Lightning storm. Oh, anything. You can ring him up.
Yep.
Just get him on the blower.
Yep.
Ken, I've got a storm coming in from Brisbane. Could you have a look at this?
Is it going to come to Tumbiumbi?
Is it going to pass Tumbiumbi? Or I might be moving down to, say, the Lakes entrance area for the weekend.
I tell you what is remarkable about that Tumbiumbi?
Just send us the bill.
The Tumbiumbi Road, HG, between Womberal and Wyong, is the straightest bit of rural road in Australia.
It's a gun barrel.
What sort of
so
distance?
I don't know how that's affected the voting here at all. I don't know.
No, we'll yes. know that.
But the Tumbiumby Road is a gun barrel.
Yes. So get Ken on the blower and talk weather. Let's have a look at that. The state of the vote in South Australia we needed
yeah,
to go
not?
To.
Why not?
Share of the vote in South Australia. It's obviously a swing to the Liberal Party
3.5%.
There.
3.5%.
Yep. And at the expense of Labor and almost everybody else bar the Democrats and the Greens.
Yep.
Do you reckon that...
One Nation's gone down a lot in South Australia, HG.
Yes,
you?
I yeah. know. Oh, well, they did.
Yeah. I think that's an interesting result, especially for the Democrats. Yeah. You know, South Australia is their home. They yes. started there.
Yes.
Having
did
any
Don Chip live in South Australia?
No, no. Well, they started being successful in the Senate with yes. Janine Haynes there. Janine Let me Haynes, rephrase
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's Natasha's home. Well, and, you know, the old knife came out from Meg Lees.
Yes.
Slip between the shoulder blades.
Yes.
On the basis that
have you got any
a little bit of smart talent was going to lift their vote.
Clean up.
And I see the stunning increase of 0.4% in their own state. I mean,
yes.
you know.
She's
where their leader is.
I mean, pretty ordinary. You'd
it's
say.
A pretty ordinary yeah. result.
She'd
for
be disappointed down in the dumps.
Well,
right
might, they, well look, Nat's not the sort to have a Nat splat, I don't think.
No,
I mean,
okay.
she's a bit more. Control than
a bit more
Cheryl.
Dignity than
a bit more control than
get
Cheryl,
the docks
but
back on.
I'll tell you what, she can't be too
on.
Happy with that. No,
no
one would be happy with that. You don't get rid of a leader and have a 0.4% increase in your own state and expect to get away with it.
No.
And I think Downer was right. They've always said that they wouldn't like to do deals. Then they did deals, and we had the ridiculous situation of Natasha saying, look, don't worry about that. You vote how you like. It's just a how-to-vote card. It doesn't really matter. We really want you to do what you like.
Right.
But then they've got a how-to-vote card saying vote Labor. Well, you know.
Well, I think the problem for Natasha was when she changed from Natasha Stott Despoja to Natasha Stott Despoja.
Oh, yeah.
I think that was where the rot set in.
Crying here in the tally room for Natasha in a few moments' time, right after this break. I think I can hold the tears back just briefly. So let's go to the break from the national count, and we'll be back with more Dump in a minute.
Is that yours or mine?
Looks like we could win some seats in Queensland, and... Ring back later.
It's in full swing here. Peter Reith has been entertaining the throng with a beautiful rendition of I Go to Rio.
Yes.
It was just
juggling.
Out of this world,
juggling
at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
And the trousers up and down as you'd expect. Tremendous work there. Now, the internet poll, we've just been killing them with the internet polls tonight. Roy?
Yes. The poll we said, actually, was is John Howard a ladies' man? Here's the result. Yes, 38%.
Yes.
No, 62%.
And what numbers? Did we get any number there of the participants?
156,000 people joined us on that one, so that is great. And we do have a new poll to set, HG, which will be of some interest, I think, to the caretaker defence minister. How much will caretaker minister of defence Peter Reith be missed? A, heaps. B, not so much. C, good riddance. D. Who? Okay, so
no.
i7.news. Sorry, i7news.com.au.
Yes, that's where you go to be part of that poll, and that's a real brain burster. That one there, set in motion here. Now, let's run through a few strong independents now tonight. We haven't had a look at the independents tonight. We go to Calair, Peter Andron's seat.
Yes.
Peter Andron's seat here.
Former newsreader, and gee, he used to read well, especially in Western Australia.
Can you give us an idea of what his style is?
Yes, good evening. Peter Andron with the Eyewitness News.
Yes.
This evening, et cetera, et cetera.
Today,
off you go.
Yes, yes, that's very good. Now, looks like he's got an enormous swing to him
yes.
of 15%. Where's that coming from, though? All over the place? The National Party's done well, the collapse of the One Nation, Labor Party has gone as well.
It's
but that's a terrific result for a popular independent.
Yes, Peter Andron. Yeah, looking on two-party preferred, he's going to blow everyone out of the water here, I'd
yes,
say.
That's a big result
71-29, indeed, in Calair.
And the Labor Party, the only possible hope there. We move on to Kennedy, Bob Catter's seat, where Bob's very, very popular, quit the Liberal Party to run on his own.
Yep.
I'm not quite sure, hardly, of course, his first time he's standing there. Losses to Labor, National and One Nation. Looks like Katter will get returned to Canberra. Let's go to the two-party preferred. Total collapse in the Labor vote.
Katter is there big time.
And now we move on to Fairfax, where we have a bludger rating for the city member, Sommelier.
Alex Sommelier. Here he is. Lovely cut of a bloke and reads a question really well.
Off a bit of paper.
Bludger rating of 99.
He's our best bludger tonight.
He's done nothing.
Yeah, 99.
He stood up once and sat down.
Yes.
And that was his 2 years, 4 months' work.
We had to go ask him to go back into the parliament and read that question to get those pictures off him.
I know that.
Now, here we have a look
there
here.
There was no one else there.
It's he's got 10.6% swing at the expense of Labor and One Nation, who just bombed out totally. Let's have a look at the two-party preferred. And we have a look there, and he's got a very comfortable seat there with 70%.
He bludgers back.
Indeed he does. He comes to Canberra with nothing in his haversack. We're off to Warringah now, and I think we have the bludger rating here with Tony Abbott, the sitting member.
Well, you'd imagine his bludger rating would be pretty low, because he does put in... known as a head kicker. Let's have a look at his rating.
22.
Puts him up in the top, say, 10% of our bell curve here of people who've put in.
Now, let's have a look at his seat in Warringah.
Had Dr. Peter McDonald running against him, a very popular independent who's pulled a lot of people from Labor by the looks of things. But he has gone down. There's a vote against.
So we go to the two-party preferred with 75% counted. Tony Abbott's back, which is good news for charities, because I've always found that you can easily raise a lot of money by organising a bit of punch Tony Abbott in the head competition.
Yes.
And people love to queue up, don't they? Just whack him in the head. And you can often charge up to $5 for that. And when you get a couple of thousand people doing it, you make a lot of money for children's hospitals.
You'd have to say he was one of the more disliked members in the House. And Peter, you might verify this. Would you say that... Tony Abbott would be one of the least liked members on your side of the House?
Excuse me, I'm just bringing home because I want to get that internet. I've got to get that internet vote up.
There's your answer.
Okay. New England. And the Tony Sinclair, have I got the latest? No, he's not right. Stuart Sinclair.
Yeah.
Sorry, it is getting on. Stuart Sinclair, he's made a bit of a gain there. But obviously Tony Windsor is out polling him. Let's go to two-party preferred with 71% counted.
Yep.
Looks like Tony Windsor joins
Tony
the
Windsor
ranks of
there.
The independents in Canberra.
And that
in
was
the big
Ian
house.
Sinclair's house, the father of the house.
Is that right?
That was Ian Sinclair's house,
See, for a minute there, I thought you said Stuart Sinclair is related to Ian Sinclair.
No,
is that
it's just
right?
accidental.
Oh, Tony Windsor on the line right now.
Tony
New England, Tony Windsor.
Away.
This has been an incredible result for you. A 23% swing away from Stuart Sinclair. Were you expecting something like this?
Oh, I thought we were in with a chance, Chris. This has been a fairly serious go, and we've had a tremendous amount of support, some of which you can hear behind me.
Well, that's almost an understatement. This is National Party heartland, always held by the Nats. How did you wrest the seat from them so comprehensively?
Oh, well, I think, with a lot of support from a lot of people, but I think, country people are really looking for a more independent voice, not one that's glued to the Liberal Party, or the Labor Party, for that matter. And we really do need to make an expression of our views independently. Country people make up 30% of
the... You're on the tooth, hungry for more, as the nation dumps here on 7.
I must say, a lot of the people in the nation will be sobered by the fact that the new Prime Minister has exactly the same laugh as the outgoing Prime Minister. I think that's what we call stability in Australia in 2001. It's party time here in the tally room. Here we go. Hey, there we go. I find there's nothing more exciting at a party than a buffhead throwing lollies into a crowd. Having got that out of my system, Roy, a couple of emails, hopefully. And I just hold on to the emails, because one of the great things about this is to welcome back the people
Western
of Perth.
Australia.
Come on back in. If I can just reach out and grab your cruets again to make sure you're on board the coverage on 7. It's tremendous to have you back. Roy, just a couple of emails to get us going.
Yes, I've got one here, HG, from Scott, Damien and Tim at the Rose of Australia Hotel in Sydney. The Rose of... Isn't that a hotel?
It is.
That's one of the
great
hotels.
One of the great
hats
hotels.
Off. Oh, yeah.
Pants off later.
I don't think it's three weeds. I think it's just one weed, the Rose. It's not the Rose Thistle and...
Oh, OK.
Yeah, it's not that one.
Sorry.
If you read this email, we'll be happy to shout everybody in our bar watching us watching the show at Tui's. P.S. Don't tell the boss. Well, I don't know who the boss is of Scott, Damien and Tim, but if the boss is watching, maybe he or she will be across the issue anyway and wouldn't mind.
I've got one here from Spanish Brown in Sydney.
Are you Spanish, yes?
Spanish regular contributor to any election coverage that Glenn, Chris and myself have worked on with you, Roy.
Yeah.
Suggesting the Ray's looking a bit bored down on Channel 9 set.
Oh, yeah.
Well, just stay tuned, Spanish. I think you're going to get the thrill of your life.
Oh, I think you're suggesting we bring Ray up for a drink.
Yes, that's right. Invite him in for some cheese and maybe a minty.
It's the rose, shamrock and thistle, that is, the three weeds.
Oh, now they're throwing
it back. You've encouraged people to throw things now.
I know. Yeah, well, you can't help them, some people. Look, earlier tonight, or in fact a few minutes ago, Jeff Parry was speaking with the leader in the Senate for the Labor Party, John Faulkner, on the tally room floor. We might go to that tape item now.
Senator John Faulkner, what's your read on how things are going tonight?
Well, it's proving tough for Labor. A pleasing result in Tasmania. I think a likely gain of at least one seat, Ballarat in Victoria. A couple of notional losses of likely, I think, in New South Wales, in MacArthur and Parramatta, which is disappointing. Michael Lee, one of our most senior parliamentarians, got a real fight on his hand in Dobell. And some patchy results, the very early figures I've seen out of Queensland and South Australia.
Were you expecting a better performance out of Victoria?
Oh, well, I think it's not just... The election wasn't going to be won or lost in Victoria. We needed to perform well there. It's been Labor's best state in recent times, as you know. We needed to hold on in Tassie, which we've done. And, of course, we needed to try and break through in New South Wales and Queensland and the campaign. Kim's been successful and the party's been successful in getting up those issues that we've been campaigning on, jobs, health and education. We really have clawed back into the race.
Yes, John Faulkner there from the Senate with Jeff Parry on the tally room floor. Let's go to some of those Queensland seats he referred to. Bowman, let's have a look at Bowman there. Now, this was a trouble... Conshaker's seat. This was going to be trouble, I think, for the Labor Party, but they look as though...
anticipating that, but I think Con's
held on. Let's go to the two-party preferred.
Yeah.
The One Nation vote may have gone both a bit back to the Labor Party. Two-party preferred in Bowman.
No, I think he's OK.
Very
he'd
close
be very
there.
Happy with that.
82% counted.
Yep.
We move on to Griffith.
Yep.
Griffith, where the ALP sitting member Kevin Rudd has had a swing to him. That's an easy gain there, even on the two-party preferred, with 59% safe Labor seat held there by Kevin Rudd. We move on to Lilly, where Wayne Swan is the sitting member. Wayne, of course, has a bludger rating. Roy, what is it?
Well, he's a very, very popular
bludger,
you'd have to say, HG. Let's have a look. 37, that's not too bad. No. He's on the good side of the 50-50 margin.
So we go to Lilly now and have a look at that in Queensland.
Yep.
Lilly, obviously...
Let's have a look
It looks to me as though on those
figures... He's improved on his figures, actually, by 3%.
A bit of a swing there.
Yep.
And obviously One Nation vote coming back to him, I'd say.
Disappeared
totally. Two-party preferred there. Labor well in control.
Yep.
We move on to Petrie, with the sitting member Teresa Gambaro.
Yep.
Bludger rating here.
Yeah, let's have a look, HG. I think about the 40s, 44.
That's indeed, right in the middle of the pack there.
Yep.
And now we have a look at the seat there, and Teresa Gambaro, as we see there, a bit of a swing to her of
5%. And that's significant.
Labor going to the two-party there. The Greens picking up a bit of a vote there, but on the two-party preferred, easily held by Teresa Gambaro. Now moving on to Brisbane.
Yep.
Brisbane, obviously, to state the bleeding obvious, a seat located in Brisbane. And Arch Bevis seat, their sitting member, looks as though he's in a bit of trouble.
He's under hammer. She's right under the hammer.
Now, that's a loss. That's a
preferences
game.
Are going to save him.
Are they? Well, I didn't read the original figures, so where are the preferences coming from?
I'm just wondering. One badge is Democrats, Greens.
Yes, Democrats vote 9.5, Greens 7.9, with 68% counted, so they've saved him there.
Yep.
And now we move on to Ford.
Yep.
Very interesting seat, Ford. I love spending time in Ford. It's the most leisurely seat in Australia.
It's the Gold Coast, HG. We've got, I think, the
Kay Ellison,
with 51%. And she's improved by over 8%. She'd be very happy with that. She's got all of One Nations there by the look.
Go to the two-party preferred with 57% counted. A safe Liberal seat now there on the Gold Coast, as you'd probably expect with the makeup of the electorate there. Very relaxed. We then on to New South Wales, and we're going to come to the seat of MacArthur, the Sheepshaggers seat. In New South Wales. This is the Paddy Farmer seat.
Paddy Farmer, the marathon runner.
He's got a gain of 11.1%. They loved what he did there when he ran around Australia to indicate the Federation was coming.
That's right. That's right. Meg Oates there, the former mayor of Campbelltown, I think three times
mayor of Campbelltown. Hasn't been able to turn it into
a vote. No, let's have a look at the two-party preferred, and Pat Farmer's going to be very comfortable here, I think.
Yes, indeed. And Chris...
Pat Farmer, before we go... we've got Pat Farmer with Chris, have we?
Yeah, we do.
We have
indeed. Let's go. Pat Farmer's joining us right now from MacArthur. Pat Farmer, pundits were predicting somewhere like a 5% win for you, even though the seat's notionally Labor, but our computer's telling us it's about 8.5% so far.
I'm sorry, can I just hear that again?
All right. We'll try and talk to you again, Pat. I was just saying that some analysts were predicting that you were going to win MacArthur by about 5%, but our computer's telling us that it's going to be somewhere in the vicinity of about 8.5%.
Yeah, well, I think that's incredible, especially when you consider at the start of the year, when I won pre-selection, everybody told me this was an unwinnable seat.
Especially, I guess, considering, too, that after the redistribution, it's notionally a Labor seat.
Yeah, I know. I think as far as that's concerned, it's just that people have had their word in this case. You know, I've been heavily involved in this community for the last 20 years, and everybody knows the work I've done out here for charities and for basically just about anything and everything that's been going on around the area. So I think a lot of that's come home. At this particular point in time, a lot of people see me as a worker for the community.
It also looks like you picked up votes at the expense of the Labor candidate Meg Oates and One Nation. What do you attribute that to?
Oh, well, they're still my people. All those people in the area are my people as far as I'm concerned. I've never seen them as being Labor people, Liberal people, One Nation or Democrats or whatever. I've just seen them as people from MacArthur and people whom I meet in the street on a daily basis. And I always said if I was going to win this seat, I had to represent everybody in the community. So I think, I'm one person who can relate to just about anybody around this area.
Pat, Glenn Milne here. Congratulations. I was just wondering about that. You were saying you had to represent everybody in that community. To what extent, though, do you think you were seen as an independent candidate rather than a card-carrying Liberal candidate?
Well, I made it very clear to everybody that I was supporting John Howard. I made it very clear to him, to everybody. In fact, I got John Howard out here to the community in the early stages of this campaign, and everybody got the opportunity to meet him firsthand and to see that he was somebody whom they could relate to rather than somebody that they just saw down in Canberra on television or in the papers. So I think that made a big difference, that the fact that everybody saw him as a good, honest man.
Yes, I know my Labor sources have told me that the Labor Party actually took resources out of your seat. They wrote it off basically 2 weeks ago and they threw it into seats that they felt they could win. Did you notice that that Labor had withdrawn?
No, I honestly believe that was just a tactic they were playing, because as soon as that was announced, I saw a lot more. There was a lot more posters going up, a lot more advertisement being done, and I couldn't help but think that was just one of their tactics. But of course, you know, I'm new to this whole game, so I wasn't sure exactly what they were doing.
And any word, Pat, from Albie Schultz, than that adjoining electorate, your Liberal colleague, who also is a bit of a maverick?
Well, no, so I'm a maverick, am I? I don't know. But look, to be quite honest with you, I haven't had a chance to speak to too many other people outside of my supporters that are here tonight and my family. And my kids have missed me over the last couple of weeks. I haven't been able to kiss them goodnight or read them a bedtime story. So I'm looking forward to doing that. So Albie Schultz will have to wait in line after that, I think.
All right. Well done, Pat Farmer.
Yes, interesting thoughts there. And do you think Peter Reith, a potential defence minister down the track, Pat Farmer?
Or Minister of Sport and Rural and Regional Development? I can see him
straight in. Material?
I'm absolutely lost for words on that one, but I think straight to the front bench is not a bad
straight
idea.
To the front
indeed.
Bench.
He can run. He can run this place.
Well, I'll tell you what, they don't so well in New South Wales, then, you know, they'll be demanding a bit of extra space
on
that front bench.
They like that New South Wales, aren't they? They're very, very
Maybe you could get rid of that Abbott bloke and put Pat Farmer in there.
Well, yes. Good
just
on you, Tony.
I'll just leave that
We've
there.
Been promoting Tony.
Obviously, the result, Roy, looks pretty well settled, but the dump continues as we keep counting right after this break on The Nation Dumps. Remember, you dumped it. All we're doing is counting it. Third there. And it looks like, obviously, a fairly safe seat for the CLP.
Oh, gee, I don't know about that. I think that's very close to call.
I've gone out on a limb.
You have gone out on a limb. Let's go
I've extrapolated.
Lingiari
in the rest of the territory, not around Darwin.
Yes, and city member is Warren Snowden.
Warren Snowden, he's got a swing to him of 3.4%. Let's go with 38% counter. Let's go to two-party preferred. And we see that
Snowden's okay.
Snowden's okay. We now move on to Hinkler. We come back to Hinkler in Queensland, where the Paul Neville is the sitting member. And let's have a look at the figures here, if we can get them up. They're obviously the current figures that we're seeing now, or the current block of votes.
Yes.
And I don't know quite what's happened there. No, oh, there it is there now. It's late there. And, wow, what's going on here?
I think that's very close, actually.
Let's go to two-party.
ALP might have this one.
Let's go to two-party preferred. 50-50 line ball, 74%. We're looking at some of the close ones. Wide Bay now. Wide Bay also in Queensland.
Yep.
And
Warren Truss, I think, is the National Party.
He's got a swing to him of 13.6.
Yep.
And everybody else is losing there. So let's go to two-party preferred. Trussie's back. He brings the truss back into the big house.
And now, Richmond.
This is the Doug Anthony seat of old, now owned by, represented by Larry Anthony. 5.2% swing there. And the problem is the green preferences may prove tricky for young lags. Let's have a look at the two-party preferred now, if we can.
I think it's looking a little bit better now for Larry Anthony, HG. He's opened up a bit of a lead there of 4%.
And so it looks like the National Party will hang on to that. And Dawson is the next seat.
Deanne Kelly
vote there. And she's got a swing to the sitting National member there of 8.5. Number of others going there towards up in their vote in the Democrats and Greens. Let's go to two-party preferred. We'll have a look at this now. It looks as though Deanne Kelly's
very comfortably returned.
Safely. And Chris, surprise me.
Guess who? Deanne Kelly from Dawson. Thanks for joining us this evening. Now, while some of your other colleagues are in trouble, you've managed a 4% swing. How'd you manage that?
I don't know. I just think people have been incredibly loyal to us here. I'm just blown away by the result. We have won booths in Mackay, in Labor Heartland, that we've never won before. So to all of those wonderful National Party people and our new voters, thank you for your support and your faith in us. We won't let you down.
What do you think was the deciding influence in the swing in your electorate?
Well, I think it was twofold. On Friday, there was a huge concentration on issues related, of course, to illegal immigrants. And I actually rang the Prime Minister last night to say how well he had handled that debate. But leadership was obviously the big thing. People were worried about national security. Can I say that the difference in the view from the political elite and decent, hard-working people in my electorate as to national security, illegal immigrants, issues of leadership was quite stark. We would read or hear something down south, and then the reaction in my electorate was very strong. So I think leadership there, then local issues like job creation opportunities and new industries here was a big issue.
Deanne Kelly, Glenn Milne here. Well, you've really made news tonight. I would have thought that's about the first time you've ever rung John Howard and congratulate him. You've been at him over things like Telstra, petrol. You're almost an anti-government candidate, aren't you, up there?
I'm a pro-people candidate, and on this occasion the government got it right, and they were absolutely pro-middle Australia, and the political elites and the Labor Party, I'm afraid, were off with the fairies.
But you have to admit you have run largely as a bit of an independent in that seat, though, haven't you? You've often bucked the government line.
Look, if you represent a big seat in Northern Australia, you're always going to be something of an independent, because the reality is that there are only 8 federal members that represent half of Australia. So you're always going to have a slightly different agenda. But can I take the opportunity, Glenn, just to thank the people in my electorate? As I said, we have won booths we never dreamt we could possibly win. People have kept wonderful faith with us, and we're going to keep it with them.
Deanne Kelly, thank you very much. Peter Reith, the Nats have done quite well, haven't they?
Yeah, no, I think they've held up well, and people like Deanne Kelly, they certainly work their electorates. You've got to give them that. I mean, she is, she can be a maverick, but you've got to also recognise that she goes from her seat down to Canberra to tell them what they think back at home. And, you know, to win marginal seats, then you've got to stand up for your electorate.
One you might just pick up, though, Labor, Lindsay Tanner, is Hinkler. Is that not right?
Yeah, Hinkler looks like it's line ball, Glenn. And obviously, if you look at the postals and absentee votes from last time, it would suggest that Labor has done fairly well in those in the past. So we would still have a chance there. Can I take this opportunity to send a cheerio and thank my own campaign workers in my own seat of Melbourne who are at the Collingwood Elderly Citizens, and I thank them very much for their commitment and their hard work. And it looks like I'll hold on to my seat in spite of a very big drop in primaries to the Greens.
Interesting, you've got the most highly educated seat in the country and you've had a 9% swing to the Greens. Does that suggest to you that that vote's come off you because people didn't like your stand on boat people?
There's no question about that, Glenn, and you can see a similar pattern on the figures in Graindler and Sydney, which are similar seats to mine. So there is no doubt that in the inner city seats there has been a substantial drop in the Labor vote, and I have no doubt that it's been the asylum seeker issue. Certainly in my own seat, that's been a very big driver of people protesting against Labor.
So was it the wrong position to take, do you think?
Oh, look, I think we're going to have to do some serious rethinking about a whole range of things over the next couple of weeks. Clearly, if the result turns out as it appears at this stage, we're going to have to go back to the drawing board. We've got a very big challenge facing us. I have no doubt there'll be a new beginning for Labor out of this election. I have no doubt we will move on onwards and upwards for the future of this country.
And
I can assure the Labor supporters out there that I'll be doing everything I can to bring that about.
Fair question for Peter Reith. A new leader, do you think?
Look, we'll obviously give consideration to leadership issues over the next week or
will
two.
Will you support Jenny Macklin? Will the left get behind Jenny Macklin?
I'm not going to make any comment about
I think you should go for it, mate. I'm not going to make any comment about leadership issues. I think Deanne Kelly did raise a point. In the same way
that I don't recall you making much comment when you were asked about you and Peter Costello, actually.
Well, we're in government, you're in opposition, and you've got a lot of things to think about.
And you're on a yacht.
And I'm on a yacht. But I tell you, one of the interesting figures, though, Glenn, is that in the last three decades, only one government has increased its vote on the previous election. And this really does make tonight an historic win if the coalition gets home, because we have seen quite a significant of our primary vote, and it is one of the problems the Labor Party's got is their primary vote has not really held up. It's been splitting.
Well, the other government, of course, was Paul Keating in 1993, wasn't it?
Well, that was the GST.
But what I'm suggesting is another big polarising issue.
He ran a scare campaign against something he was used to be in favour of, but four times only since World War II have you seen a government actually pick up a vote. Menzies did it three times, Keating did it once.
Well, in fact, this makes it an historic win for John Howard. What we've seen here, of course, Glenn, is the Liberal government run a scare campaign against something it used to be in favour of, which is boat people. So Malcolm Fraser led in the Vietnamese boat people. Now we have a very different perspective. And, of course, that has, as Peter Reith has correctly pointed out, led to a fracturing of the Labor vote to some extent.
OK, Lindsay, we have another maverick on the line now. I think Bob Catter in the seat of Kennedy.
That's right, Glenn. Bob Catter is joining us now from Kennedy. Bob Catter with a convincing win in the seat of Kennedy. John Anderson said you couldn't do this, Bob Catter, but you seem to have done it rather comprehensively.
You got to understand, the seat was a Labor seat some three elections ago, and it looks like this evening that we'll be on 70% of the vote, and that's a very high percentage, and it's been very, very humbling.
Do you feel any remorse about shattering your old party so convincingly?
No, I'm not the slightest bit interested in that sort of thing. We said to the people that we must change direction in Australia, and if we're going to change direction in all of Australia, then we will start here. And we put that question to the people. We had no money, no one to hand out how to vote cards. We had no machine to raise money. We had no backing of some major political party and their corporate sponsorship, which comes with the major political parties. And here is 70% of the vote.
Bob, Glenn Milne here. Congratulations. Do you think, Bob, that the three independents in the parliament, yourself, Peter Andren, and Tony Windsor will be caucusing now as a group, or do you think you'll just maintain your individual attitude to policy?
I think on issues such as the economic rationalist issues, I mean, if the rest of the world is free trading on 59% support in the developed countries, we're on 9%, then this obviously is economic harry-carry. And I think the three of us would be very determined to see that is to stop. And we have a very, very solid base now to work from. We hold three heartland seats.
Do you think, Bob, that the boat people issue disadvantaged independents in that it forced people to make a choice between the major parties?
Massively. And in fact, in this electorate, I could feel it out there, and I was very worried by it. There was most certainly a hatred for Mr. Beazley and his support for the fact that anyone could come into this country when they feel like it. That was a proposition which was direct.
I must have missed that. Huh?
That was even though Kim Beazley was saying he was supporting John Howard.
Oh, well, I mean, I don't think anyone believed that. Yeah, he made his stand on what he believed.
You think there were doubts in voters' minds about Labor's position?
There most certainly was plenty of doubt in my mind, and I'm sure just about everyone else in Australia.
OK, Bob Catter, thank you very much.
But also, you've got to understand that...
Thank you very much.
If I could pick up thoughts of Bob and Deanne, obviously, you know, elites, they're killing this country, aren't they? Anybody with a high school education and above has to be just weeded out and shot. Put on a boat at least to Indonesia. Is that how you're seeing it from now on?
We've got too many degrees in the parliament.
We've got far too many degrees. The more people like Deanne Kelly... In the general populace. I mean, elites, they're writing articles and letters to newspapers. They're talking out of turn. I mean, they're just baggage in this country, slowing it up. You've got Bob Catter there. Harry Carey is what it is. Harry Carey is absolutely right. What are you going to do about it in your retirement?
Well, we got you two on tonight, haven't we? So that's something.
Thanks very much, Paul.
No, I think he thought Harry Carey was free trade. I think he's a protectionist. Simple idea. Anyway.
It's for another time, though, isn't it? But elites are killing us, aren't they?
I mean, apart from sporting
elites. Yes or no?
We like sporting elites, but that's about it.
They play golf. That's all I'm worried about.
Indeed, there you go. Yes, as long as they can swing a stick, they're all right. But anyone else, like that.
Is that a problem, though? Have we seen a dumbing down of the electorate, Lindsay Tanner?
I don't think we've seen a dumbing down, but clearly there is a divide there, which is a problem for the Labor Party, because we've got different constituencies and they don't see eye to eye on some issues. So in the future, Labor is going to require a lot of imagination and creativity and courage to put together a coalition of support that's going to lead us into government. There is no doubt that there is a divide in the community emerging, which you saw in the Republic debate,
yes,
which has Labor supporters on both sides, and yes, we clearly have got a big task in front of us.
I tell you, on a policy point of view, the biggest thing Lindsay said tonight is that you ought to go back and review the boat people policy within Labor.
No,
and that is exactly what we said would happen if they got in. And I tell you, look, the Labor
Party... You're up to your old tricks yet again.
There's no tricks in this, mate.
Tell us about the video.
I'll just tell you
this. I did not say that.
I said that we would consider a whole range of things, as you always do.
I bought me telecard as well, mate.
This is worth $50,000. $50,000.
I know, I paid for it.
Now, look, we promised innovation in the coverage tonight, and one of the things about this coverage is we're going to try and cheer up other networks and, let's face it, other groups in the tally room here, people who may have been forgotten here in the tally room tonight. And Roy's brought along a little thing he's made at home.
Yes.
It's a terrific idea. What is it, Roy? Take us through it.
It's an old-fashioned dirigible, HG. I mean, it is a khaki campaign.
Yes.
We've got a dirigible here.
People fought wars with these in
they
the olden
did.
Days when there weren't any elites about.
No. What we'll try and do with this, HG, as we go to a break, we'll see if we can float this down by the ABC past Kerry, then by Channel 9 into Ray, and see how it goes, if we can direct it.
So in the break, go over to Channel 9 and Channel 2 and see if you can see the 7 Didge. We'll be back with more from the National Dump in a few minutes' time. Here it goes. Off your sheet. There we go.
Look, a little bit of exuberance out there on the tally room floor.
It's going to be one of those suits that remains in doubt after tonight, and it's going to take maybe a week to work out. I mean, with postal votes...
With the way the tally room took to the
The dirigible.
They love it.
Do they?
They love the seven dirigible. It's just going through the roof out
Can
there.
Can you see it out there now? Oh, there it is in the background of the shot. Can we turn it around? Oh. Can you drive that back into shot?
Can we see it
I
there?
Hope so.
I thought you want to drive to Channel 2 or Channel 3.
Yeah, there it is. Go past Perry.
Yes. And they must be thrilled to bits with that sort of fun element creeping into their coverage as well. Now,
it would be
Roy,
a real talking point, wouldn't it for Kerry and Co?
It would. The night we were there, the night the dirigible came over.
Yes.
Now we've got an internet poll.
Yes, it was. How much will caretaker Minister of Defence Peter Reith be missed?
Yes.
You may recall. And we have the results of that. HG. A, heaps.
Yes.
12%.
Yes.
B, not so much. 7%. Good riddance.
37%.
And who? 44%.
Yes. And we must say that a lot of that vote came from his phone card. The 44% came off his phone card. So that is an interesting statistic there. Now let's have a quick look again at bums on seats and the overall state of the house. I think that's people having trouble with it.
Hey, there it is. Okay, let's have a look, HG, at the state of the house, or bums on seats, as we like to call it. At this stage, we think the government has been returned with a comfortable working majority. On the right, we have, of course, the coalition with 82 seats. That's our projection. Others, three, the independents referred to in the last segment, and Labor, or the ALP, with 65 seats.
Now, am I right in thinking that's an increase of two to the coalition and two less to the Labor Party?
I think that's right, actually. I think there's been a trade.
So we now move on to some of the retiring ministers.
Yes.
The seats of the retiring ministers. Let's go to Flinders. Let's go to Flinders. Did you hear that one? It reminds me of the night the light globe went in Hawke's press conference.
That's right.
And he thought
he was shot.
Yes, indeed. And I hope that was some of the military people here just having a bit of firing practice at the Didge. We only put it up to see if it had drawn any enemy fire, and it has.
It would have been Peter Reith's bodyguards, of which I think there are many.
Now
returning to
Flinders.
Ah,
now
yes.
That's the seat that Peter Reith held, of course.
Yes, he held it. And Greg Hunt is the new candidate, HG, for the Liberal Party.
Yes.
With 51.4% of the vote. It's gone up 4%. And I think many feel that Peter Reith left because he wasn't going to be able to win that seat after the telecard affair.
Greg Hunt's proved him totally wrong.
Yes.
Once again. He on the two-party preferred, let's go to have a look at this, and the Liberal solid vote there and easily holding the seat. Reithy must be crying out the back somewhere here.
Just imagine, I'm the telecard affair, right?
Yes, the telecard
affair. You've got an account at Myers, you lend it to your son,
yes,
right? 5 years later, they ring up and say you owe us 50 grand.
Yes.
Are you going to say, okay, and pay it? But Reith paid up on that, even though he only got the bill 5 years later. No monthly accounts. I mean, fair crack of
work.
He did the right thing.
That's why he's so popular in the electorate.
Yes.
That's why he would have held the seat.
Well, a generous man.
He
held give his card to
Brad. He had held the seat.
Great defence.
He has left this nation in a moment of crisis.
Myers
the best defence minister since the war. Ms. Vanstone, the best defence minister since the war.
If you give me
university
bill for 50
proof,
grand,
Brigadier
5 years
McKerris.
Later, you're not getting your money.
No, you're missing the point.
You're not getting
here.
Your
He's
money.
He's left this nation in the lurch. Who is going to step into the breach? Is that bloke Tyshurst, Tumbyumby, Trekking the Storms?
Greg Hunt is stepping into the breach.
Okay,
hang on, I thought it was against the law to give cards to family members. End of argument.
Yes.
Okay, move on.
Casey.
Yes, Casey.
It's not against the law.
Now.
Hang on. Back here, please. Is it or is it not against the law?
It's against the guidelines.
The guidelines.
Oh, I
God
see.
Almighty, how silly of me.
That sort of core
and
non-core
Just you think
promises.
About that DJ's bill and ask me if you'd pay it 5 years later, a 50 grand bill.
Well, I think if I was shamed to do it, and if I'd been
an idiot,
in the first place.
As
what about
always,
those labor blokes? They go ride on a bike, they're told not to ride it, they drop off the bike, and then you and I have to pay them 70 grand.
Now, that went
as
to court.
Not me, you know. That went
to court.
We have to pay 70 grand.
We're talking about leaping Leo McClay. That went to court.
Well, I wasn't going to mention the name.
No, that's all right.
You know, that was low of you there.
Now, we move on to Casey, where Michael Woolgees has just thrilled the electorate for many, many years down there with his bedside manner. He went round to every house and asked to visit the sick as a way of holding that seat. And now, of course, we have Tony everybody's Smith, a winner. Look at that, Roy. Everybody in this seat's a winner.
Well, I think
Smithy,
that,
McKenzie,
more
Joyce.
People have moved into the electorate, I think, HG.
So we go to the two-party preferred. And we see, of course, that the Liberal without Woolridge there in his bedside manner, and the Tony Smith there holds that seat comfortably. We move on to Farrow.
Tim Fisher's old seat.
Tim Fisher's old seat down along
Bill
the River
Bott
Murray.
Bill Bott is the new candidate, Bott by name. Former President of New South Wales Shires Association. How has Bott gone?
Now, this is a three-cornered contest.
It is, a good old-fashioned one.
Yes, and it looks as though Suzanne Lay is cleaning up there. Let's go to the two-party preferred.
No, I think Bott's got it, HG, on the two.
No,
Lay's got it. You're dead right.
Yes, gee, they'd be very, very disappointed. That seat, Tim Fisher, you know, he had it by the crew.
Well, that's a...
And he squeezed them dry.
That's a boot in the date of John Anderson, isn't it?
It is. It's a terrible loss there. He'd be smarting over that. Wentworth.
Yeah, but it's a great game for the Liberal Party and another woman in Parliament.
Very good.
Okay, another
very
woman
good.
In.
And a possible defence minister.
And without a quota. Without a quota, another woman in.
And cannot use the phone. That's the thing I like about Suzanne Lay. You won't get any phone card rubbish from her. Now, we move on to Wentworth. Wentworth, and we see Peter King here for the Liberals. Look as though this would be a fairly safe seat, wouldn't it? There'd be no surprises here.
No, Wentworth. No surprises here.
Now, I tell you what, that is the seat where the ALP member wanted to try and run it closer. So as if we look at two-party preferred, I don't think she's got it much closer than previously, because she'd never seen Peter King in the electorate and would like to actually see Peter King turn up and do something in the electorate.
Oh, I think the electorate...
They did never see Andrew Thompson in the electorate.
No, he's always overseas.
Overseas studying.
Yeah, that's right.
Now...
So it's often good. Often people don't like seeing, you know, politicians in their electorate. They're much happier than me elsewhere.
And, Chris, you've got a helper here with us.
Have. It's time to check in and see what the Prime Minister's been doing. Joining me now is Mitch Catlin, live from the Wentworth Hotel in Sydney. Mitch, it's been a while since we spoke to you. What's been happening there?
Well, Chris, a lot's been happening in the last few hours, as you can imagine. The Liberal faithful have been turning up in droves. Of course, a very, very happy occasion for them. The Prime Minister is due here in around 15 to 20 minutes' time, and everyone's informed. New South Wales opposition leader Kerry Chikarovsky is here. Party President Shane Stone, former Director Andrew Robb, a number of prominent business people and well-known in Liberal ranks, including Malcolm Turnbull and Kerry Jones. So they're all here, and the champagne is flowing very, very freely. Now, the Prime Minister's staff and advisers are all here as well. I think they're most surprised about the Coalition's performance in Victoria. They're saying areas like Casey, Deakin, Dunkley, around that area, the mortgage belt of...
Beautiful drop. Emu bitter. I think they make an export bitter as well, which is even better. And just coming to some of the background information that Amanda and Stephen, you've been able to gather, is there any change or to what we've been saying all night? Is it improving for either side?
There are still, I think, a few marginal seats out there, or knife-edge seats. I mean, I'm still hopeful about Adelaide. I think Bob Horne in Paterson is a good campaigner. I think Michael Lee and Dobell, you can't write him off. I understand there's something like 5,000 postal votes there that need to be counted. I think you'll finish about 600 behind tonight. It's a bit to make up, but we've done it before, and it would be sad to see him go. We're just having a look at Western Australia. The results are starting to come in there now.
You're mentioning Brand, Stephen, weren't you?
I was mentioning Brown.
Kim Beazley's own seat.
Yeah, Kim's seat, a 6% swing at this stage, but there's only about 9% of the vote counted, and I'm sure that'll come back. But in a couple of the other seats that we see over there, Cowan, for example, 16% of the vote counted. We're seeing a 10% swing to Graham Edwards in Cowan. I think that's a sensational result. I mean, he's a great local member. I think we're seeing a couple of other... In Fremantle, we're seeing a little bit of a drift away from Carmen Lawrence
6%,
there. But only 12% of the vote counted. So it's early days in the West, but it seems to be replicating what's happened across Australia earlier in the night.
Stephen, let's assume the trend goes as it is and the Kim Beazley will be conceding in about 40 minutes' time, as suggested. What is going to be the future there? Will Kim be prepared to stay on as leader for another term?
Or? Well, I think we'd have to wait to see what Kim says tonight.
Yeah.
And again, I wouldn't presuppose what he will be saying later. I think...
But these things must have been thought about in...
Oh, I'm sure Kim thought about it. Yeah. There's no doubt about that. Yeah. And we thought he was going to be the Prime Minister. Now, that hasn't happened tonight. Yeah. And Kim, I'm sure, has given some thought to it. I said earlier, I don't think you could have found someone to run a better campaign for us. I mean, I think he went out and campaigned under very difficult circumstances. He worked his bum off around Australia, and we had some positive agenda items out there, and sadly tonight that hasn't given the reward to Kim that I think he deserved.
Amanda, on these figures that we're seeing, what any movement in the Senate at all?
I think there's very hopeful signs for us of picking up a third seat in New South Wales, which will be very pleasing.
Yes.
Swing against the Democrats in the Senate there.
How about the King of the Kids in Queensland? I know it's not your party, but Ronnie Boswell, does he look as though he could...
The last figures I saw did look like Ron could just do what I think a lot of people want and win that seat, which would be great.
One Nation in trouble in Queensland?
Yeah, they're the last figures that I saw.
Okay.
But look, can I just come back to this issue of, you know, Kim's run a fabulous campaign and all the issues were against him. Look, I'm sorry. Politics is about the issues. He's had 5.5 years. And Labor just can't keep saying when the economy goes bung and they're in government, oh, it's an accident. And when they don't win a campaign, oh, the issues were against them. I'm sorry, you just, sooner or later, you've got to take responsibility and face up to the fact you've had the bloke for 5.5 years and it hasn't worked out. I'll give you a scoop here. I've just heard, because I've been away to do some radio, that the Beazley camp have rung the radio in West Australia and said he will be announcing tonight that he's resigning straight away.
Well, I mean, I don't know how you'd know that, because we have to wait to see what Kim's
going
to say.
It's a surprise for me to find that out from and be able to tell you, but that's what they've been talking about on radio.
Well, I might know a bit.
I'm not telling you a secret.
I might know a bit more, but I'm certainly not going to tell you here.
It wouldn't be a surprise, though, would it? I mean, look, this was his last shot in the locker, wasn't it?
Glenn, it may not be a surprise tonight. There's no doubt about that. Kim has been there for a long time. He has been a very successful minister in government. He's been a very successful deputy prime minister. He's been the leader of the party. People have forgotten that in 1996 there was a real chance for the Labor Party to tear itself apart. Kim Beazley kept us together. Kim Beazley made us again competitive. And in 1998, 1,500 votes cast differently, we would have won.
Who's going to do it this time, keep the party together?
Well, I mean, that's not for tonight. There are issues that I'm sure we'll think about. These are issues which we've still got to come to grips with in terms of who's going to be there. There are still some knife-edge seats that exist, and some very good people are still going to be elected to the parliament to represent Labor. I feel very confident about. So in terms of the future, let's see what happens in the next few days.
And that's something maybe we can pick up in a moment and talk about some what the future might be for the ALP.
And as you can see, drama aplenty here still to come on the Nation Dumps. And let's have a look how that dirigible meditated a sad and sorry end as we go to the break here in the National Tally Room. Amanda Vanstone there shopping to shopping her way back into Parliament. Amanda, have you played that CD you bought?
Yes, I have, actually. Yes. I took it back to the campaign office in Melbourne and played it, and I said, this CD purchase, this is going to win us the seat of Dixon.
Very good. Now
does South American music talk to you?
Not a lot. I mean, no. Look, I like it for a limited period of time, and then I've had it for a while. I'll bring it out in a few months and maybe give it another run.
A little bit goes a long way.
A little bit goes a very, very long way. Like real cream.
I'd agree with that.
And now we're joined by Amanda's Senate colleague and leader of the Democrats, Natasha Stott-Despoja. And Roy, you've been looking at the Democrat vote and you're slightly worried about it.
Well, it seems to me that the Democrat vote is reasonably flat. And the Green vote, on the other hand, has actually gone up quite a bit. Any theories as to why, Natasha?
Well, first of all, I'm quite relieved that we've not only maintained, or to use your word, flattened our vote in the House of Reps, but it's actually increased in all states and territories. But clearly, I think the Greens have taken votes from the Labor Party, and this, I think, is also part of the residual resentment towards the GST, and that's something the Australian Democrats recognise. And are very glad that we were able to maintain our vote in light of that. So it was a tough campaign for us, and yet we've managed to increase it even slightly across the board in the House of Reps.
Do you think you've been able to lure any Liberal vote disappointed with their stand on some of the, obviously, the biggest issue in the campaign, and that was the Tampa crisis slash asylum seekers?
I think that's a small part of our vote, but certainly I think the high proportion of vote for non-mainstream parties, so Democrats as well as the Greens, reflects the fact that there are a lot of Australians out there who aren't happy with the bipartisan approach to asylum seekers and refugees. But a boost in the environmental vote is a good thing all round, so that's something that we do support.
Now, just a quick run through. Some of the people are leaving, and we've mentioned these already tonight. Michael Woolridge is going, Peter Reith is going. We've got, obviously, Tim Fisher cashing in chips, and we've got Johnny Fay going. Which will you miss the most?
Oh, there's a challenge. I'm not sure how much we'll miss all of them, but I wish them all well. How's that?
Beautiful answer, Glenn.
Yeah, wonderful answer, I think. But I'm just a bit worried, Natasha, that you might be blaming poor old Meg Lees there still for the Democrats' vote.
No, I don't think it's to do with a particular person, but clearly, I mean...
But she did the deal, of course, on the GST as leader.
Well, it was supported by a majority of colleagues, so it's not about individual people, but I do acknowledge that at the beginning of this year we were polling 3%. We've managed to increase that. I'm pleased with that, but I still think, you know, it's too close to call, but in the Senate, I think there's going to be a very strong coalition vote, and I think that's going to be, as I've said from day one as leader, very tough to retain our 5 out of 9 Senate seats that are up for re-election. I've always said that.
I'm interested in the fact that the Greens vote has gone up by so much.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Brown, who's the leader of the Greens, took a very, very tough stand on boat people, whereas I think you tried to tread a much more middle ground line, did you not? Do you think that cost you?
That's absolute rubbish. In terms of being the only parliamentary party to vehemently oppose the government's legislation, and you only have to look at the work of Senator Andrew Bartlett in the Australian Senate, and you can see that he put in not only the long hours but asked the questions and scrutinised that legislation along with the Greens.
But you never said the bombing should stop and the troops should not go, did you?
In relation to asylum seekers, but we certainly did. From day one in relation to the terrorist crisis, certainly we've put on record our concern at the deployment of troops, but we do recognise one reality. Troops are over there, and the fact is, I think all Australians send them their best, the fact that they've been deployed. But from day one, we said parliamentary ratification of troop deployments. But I think certainly the pro-environment vote and the dissatisfaction among the electorate with the handling of the Tampa issue has been reflected in the vote for the Democrats and the Greens. I'm just very pleased that we've increased our vote in the House of Representatives. That's very, very positive for us tonight.
Do you think, though, now the challenge for the Democrats is to sharpen the differences once again with the major parties, rather than being seen to be too similar to them?
I don't think we're perceived as similar to them. I think that there is an obvious differentiation. I think a lot of Australians are still fed up with the bipartisan approach to many issues, including the environment, including asylum seekers, including the issue of deployment of troops. And I think they're looking for alternatives, and that's why there's a relatively high non-mainstream vote reflected in the polls tonight. How that translates in the Senate is another issue.
There were several candidates tonight who made the point that they felt your preference deal with Labor had hurt you in the sense that it made you look much more mainstream.
I haven't heard those criticisms this evening, but I think that's a lot to do with the way the issue has been sort of beaten up. I think people need to remember that individual voters control their own preferences. And if preferences determine the outcome in certain seats or in the Senate, well, then that's a deliberate choice by voters to vote one for whatever party and then send their preferences down the ballot paper. But I'd like to see how to vote cards, you know, abolished altogether, Glenn. So I think this notion that, you know, people can't control their own, that is a furphy that's often sent out by the two old parties, and I'm sure that Amanda Vanstone wants to have a chat about that right now.
Look, I think your Senate vote's fallen. I just think you can't keep having it each way. You can't say you don't want the media to photograph you in bikini tops if you take them out to beaches and wear them. And you can't say...
I knew that we'd get personal attacks from Amanda tonight. I knew that we could rely on the fact that at least we'd get personal attacks
into directing preferences to the Labor Party in marginal seats. I mean, you are kidding yourself if you think you can honestly shift from split tickets to giving your preferences to Labor and then saying, oh, it's not really a deal, you can vote whichever way you like.
Well, Amanda knows full well that we have
each way every time, Natasha, as leader. Those days are finished.
It's always a very interesting question I find when Amanda usually takes half an hour to come at you.
Yeah.
And then you think, well, I've forgotten an original point in the first place.
I just think it reflects a certain cockiness because the government's feeling pretty good right now. So anyway, they're going to have to work with
campaign.
Us in the Senate.
I know you've been critical of the media of it, but in fact the positioning of the Democrats in the campaign I thought provided easily the most interesting and refreshing pictures, at least. Whereas instead of seeing...
Especially that baby photo, huh?
Well, the baby photo notwithstanding, I think that the fact that the Democrats were able, pictorially at least, if that matters, to cut himself away from the other two parties would have been a plus with certain percentage of the voters.
I would have thought too, actually, that given that the Democrats were firmly going for the youth, going for the younger set, with 25% unemployment, I would have thought more of the younger set would have gone to you. What do you see the problem being there?
We weren't necessarily targeting the youth vote. We've always enjoyed, well, certainly in the last 18 couple of years.
As Senate candidates.
But is that wrong? We've had an 18-year-old. In times of trouble,
people look to wisdom, and you don't usually go to 18-year-olds for wisdom. You usually go to someone
slightly
older.
And there's the wisdom over there.
I was going to say, looking at wisdom in the Australian Parliament.
Hasn't your vote fallen in the Senate in New South Wales and in South Australia, your own state?
I think it's too early to look at the Senate figures, but I'm not surprised if that's the case. I mean, we have certainly said from day one that we're anticipating that it would be difficult to get 5 out of 9 back. But in relation to the youth vote, I mean, we've always said that we, not just a, you know, looking towards the youth vote, but obviously wanted to get a broad array, like get a diverse and different representation of people, not only in the Parliament, but in terms of their votes. And I think it'll be interesting to see the demographics, but I'm pretty convinced that where we got votes, it's pretty much across the board in terms of ages.
But the point is if you want to change politics, you're never going to change politics if you appear exactly the same as, you know, Amanda and Stephen here. You've got to cut yourself away from that and then draw the vote to it.
Sorry, I didn't know that I looked the same as Amanda and Stephen, or nor did my party, but I think that there is clear differentiation between us and them on a range of issues, and one of those issues is the fact that, you know, personal attacks don't cut any weight, but
no,
in terms of policy...
You succeeded.
I think we did too.
Yeah, well I found the concept of just changing politics a little bit baffling, because what did you mean by change? What's the definition here of change? Change it to what?
Well, we wanted to have a political system that wasn't just about gladiatorial, you know, debate about this. It's two dogs barking is the expression we use. But also
well, it's called
we wanted
the adversarial system. That's
part of the Westminster
system. By law,
system.
That's the way it works.
Yeah, but in the Senate, that's not how it necessarily works because no one party controls the Australian upper house. There has to be some form of negotiation and consensus and compromise. And we've always acknowledged that. And we've said that's why we're prepared to work with whichever party gets into power, whether it's Labor, whether it's the coalition. And we'll continue to do that to try and bring about the best and fairest and greenest laws for all Australians.
Natasha, aren't they conflicting messages, though, to say, on the one hand, there are two dogs barking, and then to take one of the dog's preferences?
We did a preference. Remember who we did a preference deal with across the board in the upper and the lower houses? Nationally, it was the Greens. And you've seen an interesting result for both Greens and Democrats was tonight, particularly in the House of Representatives. But we do have a preferential system. We've never ruled out negotiating on preferences. Contrary to what Amanda Vanstone says, in the past, we haven't just issued split tickets, but certainly, of course, in the Senate, that's what we did. But our votes have gone through in terms of suggesting where preferences go through the Greens. Firstly, whether it's in the Senate or the House of Reps.
But you're on record as saying you prefer split tickets. You prefer people to make up their own mind. But when you become leader, you do a deal that favours Labor in the marginal seats that are critical to them.
And we also
and then you
preference
say it's not really
to the coalition.
A deal, people can vote how they like.
Well, that's the reality, Amanda. People can vote how they like. And that's what's, I think, it'd be very interesting to see how people have voted.
Just
and I think a lot of Australians actually
said,
made. A lot of Australians have actually made their own decision about where their preferences will go. And I think because in many seats, and particularly the Senate, it will come down to the wire. I don't deny that. Democrats, it'll probably come down to the wire as well. It'll be interesting to see what decisions people have made as to where their vote travels if their first choice doesn't get elected.
That's right. Look, Natasha, thanks very much for stopping by. I thought the line of the...
And you can stay if you like.
Yeah, if you want to. You sit in with us. Look, I thought the line of the campaign was when you described John and Kim as the two Ronnies. And I just must say, though, I just didn't know which younger Democrat would have a clue who the two Ronnies were. It was terrific. And look, thanks very much
big
for stopping
Kevin,
by.
Big Ken, Kevin, Mr. Sheen might have been a bit closer.
Yeah, indeed. And look, as we go, let's go to the share of the vote before we go to the break here on the Nation Dumps. And I'm not sure what... Yes, the share of the vote, Roy.
Yes, let's have a look. Labor, 38.5. That's sort of stayed consistent. 37% Liberal. Nationals, 5.7. Democrats, 5.4. Greens has gone up as we thought. Yes, so that's the share of the vote across the nation at the moment.
And now, finally, let's go to Hindmarsh before we go to the break.
Oh, Chris Gallus's seat.
Yes, Chris Gallus's seat.
Yep.
And what have we got there, Roy? You look as though you've got the increase in the vote there for the Liberals.
Yes. And Georgianis is in trouble. Yes, Chris Gallus is back, I think.
Okay, let's quickly go to the two-party preferred.
although it could be 50-50.
Let's have a look. Oh, points out.
No, it was 50-50 last time we looked, so I think the trend is going towards Chris Gallon.
We came back from the fill there. We saw deliriously happy parents and people from all over Australia packing into the national tally room here tonight for the count.
Celebrating democracy.
Now, we're going back to Field Marshal...
Malcolm McCurris.
We are. Malcolm, could I just ask maybe for a quick overview of the Senate? Have you had a chance to dip the toe into that water?
Absolutely no change in the Senate, but I think the Greens will take the Democrat seat in Western Australia, so the result will be that there'll be 7 or 8 Democrat senators compared with 9 in the last Parliament. That's actually quite a good result for the Democrats, in point of fact, bearing in mind how badly they were doing earlier in the year.
And Ron Boswell back?
Probably. But can I make the observation, the National Party have done disastrously in this election. I can't imagine what ever made Peter Reith earlier on think otherwise. This is a disastrous result for them. They're down to 12 seats in the House of Representatives. They have lost 4 seats. The seats are Kennedy, New England, Hinkler to Labor, and Farrer to the Liberal Party, probably. Now, that means the Liberal Party has succeeded in wrecking the National Party, wrecking One Nation, coming back to this reputable win, which is very like Labor's win in 1993. It's very striking how like the faces are of the Labor people in 1993 with the Liberals this time. That is, they've had a disreputable win in each case. The next election will be a landslide against the government that won a disreputable victory. And I'm very struck at how similar this is with the party roles reversed between the Keating win in 1993, when Dr. Hewson lost the unlootable election, and the Howard win this year when Kim Beazley lost the unlootable election.
And do you think that'll be the title of your thesis, 1993 revisited in 2001?
With the party roles reversed. That is, the Liberal Party having a disreputable win this time and Labor having had a disreputable win last in 1993 and discrediting in each case, which is headed for a massive defeat at the next election. I will say this. My main law of electoral history is this. He who loses the unlootable election never gets another chance. But the party always goes on to win the next election under a different leader. I can give you a dozen cases of that. Kim Beazley has lost the unlootable election just as John Hewson did. And the result of the next election will be the same with the party roles reversed.
OK, now, we might leave it there. I think Kim Beazley is now making his way into his electoral office in Western Australia, in Perth, HG.
I think it might be the party there, Roy, at Rockingham. Where they've got a bit of a stage set up. We'll keep an eye on that. Just see if we could
I think we'll probably go there pretty quickly, HG. It looks as if he's got something to say. In fact, he's even written something down.
Roy, maybe we should cross over to Western Australia now.
Well, friends and colleagues, great campaign workers for the Labor Party, I am that proud of the Australian Labor Party, its members of Parliament, its workers in the field tonight. We have fought a magnificent campaign. A magnificent campaign in adverse circumstances. And we have held on to a position which I could not believe we would 5 weeks ago, and I'll say more about that a little bit later. But I have to tonight, I'm afraid for all of you, I have to concede defeat. We have lost this election. There is no doubt about that, and I congratulate Mr. Howard on his re-election. I hope as Prime Minister of this country for some time that he has and does bear in mind the concerns and needs of all Australians, whatever their background in the time that remains to him as Prime Minister of this nation. I congratulate him on his re-election. Can I say this? 5 weeks ago, it looked as though we in the Labor Party faced one of the most devastating defeats in our history. It is an extraordinarily difficult thing to conduct an election campaign against the background of an ongoing war, and in circumstances where people feel a great sense of insecurity. Governments all around the globe have been the beneficiaries of massive public support as the people of each nation turn to the leadership and the government of the day in order to get themselves a sense of comfort and security. To conduct an election campaign against this background from opposition is the most difficult task that any opposition can undertake. And I am so proud of the way we've fought it. We have stood four square for the security of the Australian people, but we have also offered more. We've looked down through the fog of war to the kitchen table of the average Australian family. And we've listened to those who sit around it. We've listened to their hopes and their dreams, the aspirations that they have for their young folk that they get a decent education, the aspirations and concerns that they have to ensure that they have access to affordable health care, their love of the future of this nation and the determination they have to see it as a constructive and creative nation, a nation where people don't leave when they have bright ideas but come here when they have bright ideas. We alone in the Labor Party brought these issues to the campaign table. And let me tell you in on a secret, they're not going to go away. They're not going to go away. I'm afraid to say that crisis in aged care, health, the problems in our public schools, they'll all be there tomorrow. They'll all be there as a massive challenge to government. There will be a broader challenge to government too. How are we going to be able to draw upon all our people, whatever their background, whatever racial group they come from, whatever cultural background they have, whatever religious background they have? How are we going to draw on the strength of all our diversity to ensure that we as a nation survive and prosper? This now is a very real challenge. We don't stand these days where we did once, in the high regard of the nations of the region around us. And yet in that high regard lies crucial elements of our security. This is the future challenge for government, how we address these things and deal with these things. And it cannot be said that the election process that we have just been through necessarily assists that. But what can assist it is the natural coming together of the Australian people after a great political contest, to think about the things which unify all of us and the gratitude we ought to have for being able to share in the prosperity of this lovely land, to be able to share in the prosperity of this lovely land. It's a challenge for all of you, but it's a challenge that I will be joining you in as a humble backbencher shortly. It is not... It is not my intention to remain as leader of the Australian Labor Party. It has been an enormous privilege for me to lead this great party, this 100-year-old party, this party that has so much of Australian history bound up in it, the greatest political party and one of the greatest Australian political achievements, the fact that it exists, still there fighting and battling for the needs and concerns of the ordinary Australian, through every hardship that they confront and through every political difficulty that we confront. So I bow out of Labor Party history now in gratitude, and gratitude to all of you. Ordinary members of the Australian Labor Party have stood so four square with us over the years. And I've got a few... I thank you for your support, but please don't make this any harder than it is, because I've got some people to thank. Later, mate, just if I could just conclude. Can I just say these things? Firstly, there are a lot of people I need to thank, and I start with the broad rank and file of the Australian Labor Party, all of you who work so hard for it. As I watch our political opponents pay their booth workers on a day like today, and all you get paid is psychic capital. You get paid the the contribution of your love and your labour for our great party. So I start by thanking the rank and file of the Labour Party around the country. And then I go to my caucus colleagues who've assisted us so well in this campaign. My backbench and frontbench colleagues. It would be invidious for me to mention, impossible for me to mention all of them to whom I owe a debt. But I will start with the deputy leader, my deputy leader, Simon Crean. A greater, loyaler deputy no one could wish for. And didn't he clean Peter Costello's clock in this election campaign? And thanks too to colleagues who sat, if you like, in the engine room of the actual campaign itself. I think here of Bob McMullen, of John Faulkner, of Stephen Smith, who unseen and behind the scenes made a massive contribution to the way in which we did our advertising. And I thank all my other front bench colleagues for the way they're prepared to get out there and fight in the marginal seats, though many of them hold seats by a hair's breadth themselves. Unselfishly, they went and joined their colleagues in circumstances where they might have been inclined to stay home, basically because they wanted a win. They wanted so much a victory for this country and a victory for our party. And can I thank, too, the party organisation? I think in particular of Jeff Walsh, our National Secretary, who's done such a fine job. I thank all our state secretaries and the state branches of the party who have assisted him and those on his campaign team operating out of Melbourne. They have done so very, very well indeed, and my gratitude goes to them. And then can I go to my staff? My staff here in Brand, who've kept the home fires burning, and it seems as though we've won again tonight. And then my staff in Canberra, who sacrificed so much to work for the Australian Labor Party. It will be impossible to mention them all without getting emotional, but I must mention one who stands to represent all of them, Michael Costello, my chief of staff. He sacrificed massively to come to my office, and he has been a marvellous coordinator of all our activities, and the staff tell me an enormously humane boss. But to me, he has been a guide and mentor and encouragement. I do thank him so much for that. And can I thank our ex-Labor leaders and prime ministers who came out so cheerfully for us in this election campaign? They all did. But Bob Hawke particularly was everywhere, and I do thank him for what he did for us too in this election campaign. But above all, can I thank my family, Susie, my daughters, who've been such a marvellous help to us in this campaign and such a marvellous help to me over the years. At one level, I regret this result enormously. In fact, 99% of me regrets this result enormously. But there is 1% reserved, which says that the gone fishing sign that goes up on my door means I've actually gone home. And what a wonderful reward that is to be able, after 21 years in political life, to be able to return to such a magnificent and supportive family. But tonight, I just bow out by thanking the Australian people. We are a great nation. We have a nation with a capacity to be better. We have a nation with a capacity for a generosity of heart. Like any nation, there are bleak angels in our nature, but there are also good angels as well. And the task and challenge for those of us in politics is to bring out the generosity that resides in the soul of the ordinary Australian. That generosity of heart, so that we as a nation turn to each other and not against each other in the circumstances which we face. There is one key thing to all of this, I do believe, and that is this. It must always reside in the intentions and hearts of the political parties of this nation. that they do understand what an ordinary Australian family feels. And that as we look to security internationally, we look first to the security in the hearts and minds of those around the kitchen table, because there's no doubt at all that a sense of generosity and sense of generosity in the hearts of an average citizen often starts with a sense of security at home. And if they do not feel a sense of security, then their capacity to feel a generosity is often marred. Now, that has always been a challenge that we in the Australian Labor Party have understood. A great 100-year history of the Australian Labor Party continues. We have saved enough of a great caucus to be able to ensure that at the next election campaign, we will put forward an alternative government that will win. Thank you very much.
Yes, quite a speech there. Quite a speech there from Kim Beazley, which drew applause in the tally room behind
great
us
speech.
Here. And obviously Kim conceding defeat and saying he's going to step down from the leadership of the Labor Party. And I think on that positive note, or, you know, that dramatic note, should I say, it's time for a break from the nation's capital. We'll be back with more Dump in a minute or two.
Does he hold grudges in that way? I noticed Tony Jones was a bit hard last Thursday night on Late Line. Will he hold a grudge against Tony, do you think?
Well, I think our relationship is still a little brittle since I asked the Prime Minister on Friday morning what he thought the community attitude would be to boat people if they were white Zimbabwean farmers.
Yes.
English-speaking with children with golden locks.
Yes, and the response? I find that question offensive?
Correct.
Okay.
Now, just quickly before we go on, obviously Kim has conceded the election tonight and has stepped down from the Labor Party leadership. Glenn, you know, before we come to the panellists, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on a likely new leader.
Well, first of all, I might say I think Kim Beazley almost looked relieved. That was the thing that struck me about that speech.
Yes.
The other point I'd make is that, you know, he was talking about race and religion and diversity, and he was almost talking about healing. But, of course, the problem is that Kim Beazley took the same stand on these sorts of issues during this campaign as John Howard. And I think there's going to be a recognition inside the Labor Party now that that was the wrong thing to do. Now, in terms of new leaders, I think Simon Crean will probably be the temporary leader of the Labor Party, but I don't think he's a viable electoral proposition, and I think the Labor Party knows that already.
And I remember you writing an article, I think, for The Australian concerning on the strategy for the Labor Party, which now looks as though it hasn't produced government. Will this cause also some comment in the ranks?
Absolutely. I think the Labor Party's got a huge rethink to do now. That that article you referred to was a leaked memo that went from Kim Beazley, one of his senior advisors, to Michael Costello, the man he praised so profusely there, his chief of staff. And basically it outlined the small ball strategy. Don't be a big target. Tuck in behind John Howard. Don't make too many big points of difference and you'll roll home on an anti-GST wave. Well, it didn't work, and the architects of that strategy are going to have parts of their anatomy nailed to the wall, I'd imagine, tomorrow.
Is that how you see it, Stephen? Is some of you going to be nailed to the wall? Is your, you know, night tools being feeling sensitive tonight?
No, I'm not feeling sensitive. I'm feeling disappointed. I'm elated at the speech that Kim has given, because I think it shows the sensitivity of him as a leader. He has been a tremendous leader for the Labor Party in difficult circumstances of the last 5 years. He did extremely well in 1998, came very close to winning government after just one term, and of course, over the last 3 years, I think, has espoused a future for Australia where he wanted us to go. The people have decided that they didn't want to go there. The people have decided they'd stick with the government on this occasion, although it seems that we're talking about essentially numbers being much the same as before, with a couple of seats shifted around, although, as I keep saying, there are still some knife-edge seats and who knows how close it's going to be. But in terms of the wash-up after tonight, I guess it means the Labor Party once again has got to regroup. What we have to do is to go through a period of looking at what we stood for in this election. The Labor Party is good at that, but I think what we've also been doing in opposition in the last couple of terms is to have that introspection without a whole bunch of infighting and bloodletting and so on. And of course, I think that we've grown up enough now in the Labor Party to be able to do that again.
What other leadership candidates would there be, Stephen? Bob McMullen would be obviously in the frame as a deputy.
No, we certainly can't.
Chance you're up, have a guess.
We cannot talk about that tonight for the simple reason, of course, that all sorts of candidates that still have their fates decided.
Yes.
And I just suspect that what we need to do is to have some time to think about what's happened tonight. We need to reflect on what Kim has said. We need to think about where we need to go as a party and how we can best address that, because I think there are going to be some substantial changes within personnel and some within our organisation structure as well.
Sure.
So there's a whole raft of things that are likely to flow.
Stephen,
tonight's not
Stephen,
the night
can
to
I ask you
about.
One question? Do you think there will be a rethink on the position on vote people?
Well, again, I think Lindsay Tanner indicated that the vote tonight would seem to indicate that there are elements of the Australian community that were concerned about Labor's stance. Now, we tried to argue a particular case. I think the people of Australia in the main believe that the government of the day has the right to protect its borders, and we supported the incumbent government with its legislative base to do that. There are some, however, when you separate the question of border protection from the way in which we deal with refugees and asylum seekers, and I think there's been an overlapping of some of the arguments that's there. But look, as I said, the Labor Party is big enough and ugly enough to look after itself. We'll go back, we'll look at all these issues, and I think what we will do, we've got a very good base. I mean, we haven't been wiped off the face of the earth. We're out there, we're competitive. We've got some good people that are still in there, some excellent people got elected in 1998, and I reckon we've got a great team to kick on with.
I think, Glenn, your question there to Stephen is I think both sides will be re-evaluating their attitude towards boat people, so to speak, because it's unsustainable, the policy as it stands. The country won't be able to afford to have the Navy doing nothing but patrol all the time, nor will it be able to afford to bribe, essentially, other Pacific countries to take these people.
Well,
there's going to have to be another...
The Navy's not doing nothing but that. And, yeah, I mean, you're making the assumption that there's been no impact at all on the inflow into Indonesia. I mean, we knew there were people piling up in Indonesia, a big queue of people, who were nonetheless going to have a go at coming. But you might have heard the Prime Minister say the other day he had advice that the inflow into Indonesia of people having a go was tapering off. I don't think you can judge this yet. I don't think you've got any information on which to judge that it will not be a successful move to send a message that the back door is not the way you're going to come in.
Amanda, on the one hand, you're still bombing the very source of where these people are coming from. They're trying to get out in their millions still.
Well, many are, and they're of course going to countries of first asylum. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about people who bypass a number of countries of first asylum they could have and simply choose to say... There's a lot of countries between Pakistan and here.
Yes.
And going through those countries and saying, well, this isn't my choice. I really want to go to Australia. And by the way, I just think I'll breach the maritime border. But, well, I'll come back to the subject of boat people if you like, but I'd just like to agree with Steve. I thought that was a very generous speech of Kim Beazley's.
Sure.
A difficult speech to make for anybody, whatever party you're in. A very gracious one and very well delivered, and quite properly thanking all his campaign workers and his team.
And that's coming from Amanda Vanstone here on The Nation Dumps. And we'll return to more of the issues connected with seats and Malcolm and Kerris's predictions that 2001 is just like 1993. Right after this, the climax is yet to come from the Canberra tally room. Oh, sorry, hang on. What am I doing here?
Maps. Look at this. Sydney,
I thought that was a pretty good in, by the way.
I know.
I thought I sold that in pretty well.
So I did too. But maps, let's talk maps.
Before. I misunderstood.
Here's before. Let's have a look at after.
what's that going to tell us?
Now.
They got Lindsay and now.
Well, that's a great map. Stephen's not convinced about the before part of the map.
Chifley was always Labor's and it still is.
Right.
Brisbane. There we see a rhythm of blue sliding through those Labor seats there, slicing through.
Yep.
And let's see if I can pick up. Dixon's gone now to the Liberal Party, Cheryl Kernow.
Cheryl's gone.
Ryan's come back.
Well, that map's out of date.
The map's out of date already. Well, perhaps let's forget maps. If anyone raises the subject of maps again, let's just go to the break.
But speaking of Cheryl Kernow, Chris!
Ah!
Cheryl Kernow, thanks for joining us this evening. You must be a bit disappointed.
Yes, I am. I'm sad as well as disappointed. But I know I did my best, Chris, and it was always hard, very hard. Only had 176 votes to spare, and when there's a 2% swing on, pretty hard to withstand that. I wasn't able to, obviously.
How much do you think your attempts to smear the Liberal candidate, Peter Dutton, had an impact on the result tonight?
No. I think it's 4 years cumulative effort on behalf of my opponents. Certainly, I mean, I have made some contribution to the outcome, but it's been a four-year campaign, Chris, and all of my colleagues can tell you what goes on in Parliament in question time and what's been going on in Dixon. So I think it bears some analysis, and I'll take my own responsibility, but it's much more complicated than that. So much, though, I think I'll have to write a book about it.
What sort of dirty tricks would you include in any tell-all book that you publish?
Dirty tricks, just my side of the story. There's a lot that's not on the record so far, and I want to put it on the record to make sure the full story is told.
Well, what is off the record that you could tell us about tonight? Give Roy and HG a scoop.
Nothing. No. Much as I love them, much as I really admire their political perceptiveness and their values, not tonight.
All right, well, dirty tricks aside, what do you think the telling issues were in Dixon?
The tell-all book intrigues me. Peter Dutton there winning the seat of Dixon, and so Cheryl and Kim both,
bow out.
Yes, not completely, but still with us. Let's go to the break. Look, I won't do a big build-up for the break because
maps.
The last time... Maps! Interrupted. And obviously you can tell that it's winding down here in the telly room, but we're still having fun, and that's what it's going to be till we finish up here in the National Capital this evening.
The world's finest.
And
Peter, 11 in a view on what the final total might be?
Yes. I think we might end up with 8 more than Labor. Something of that order. Here comes the boss.
Yes, here comes the boss. And he's out of the elevator, and he looks as though he's gesturing to where he'll be making a speech from. And he's got quite a lot of the relatives in tow with him, Roy. And he greets, obviously, deliriously happy campaign workers on the way in. And he walks into a very big cheer in the Wentworth Hotel in Sydney. And I'm just wondering, Roy...
Yes, well, it won't take long for him, I suppose, to get to the podium, HG, where he may or may not work from notes. I think he's probably better not working from notes. And let's see what the message will be, one of healing, unity, moving forward.
Thanking the opponent.
If that's right, graciously accepting.
And put up a great thing. We took it week by week, day by day, seat by seat. You're only good as
we
your last
no
seat.
We made no assumptions. We accept the trust of the people.
I'm going to stay for the next...
We'll
I love it so much. I'm going to stay for 3 years, and we'll have another election in 2004.
Yes, and
I'll
be back.
And we hope that Peter Reith can come back and join him in 2004.
As a special advisor on matters to do with defence.
And phone
and Collins Pass subs and what
look,
have you.
I always love a leader who points to people in the audience.
Yeah,
whom
he doesn't know.
That's right. I've never seen before in his life. And now if we can pick up the sound, we may be able to cross to the Wentworth Hotel in Sydney.
Please. Hey, thank you. Please. Ladies and gentlemen, I first wish to address some remarks to all of my fellow Australians. I cannot express to you the sense of honour and privilege I feel in once again being elected as Prime Minister of the greatest country in the world.
Yeah.
My resolve, my commitment, my dedication is to the service of the Australian people in the years ahead. We face, as a nation, some new and unexpected challenges. All of us are deeply conscious of the changes that have come over the world and therefore over our own nation since the terrible events in the United States of the 11th of September. And it requires of all of us of goodwill and of faith in freedom and a belief in the great principles upon which this nation has been built, that we come together, we bind together in unity, not only one with the other, but also with like-minded people around the world. We do face... Those terrible deeds were done to us as much as they were done to our American friends. And we have a duty as part of the free world to respond to them. I would like to thank Kim Beazley, the leader of the Australian Labor Party, for his gracious words. He was kind enough to ring me earlier this evening. I thank him for that. I pay respect to him as an honourable political opponent. I wish him and his wife Susie and his family well, and I record my respect for the contribution that he has made to his own party. Can I say to all of the members of the and supporters of the Liberal Party of Australia, what a wonderful result tonight is. Won for the third time, but this is the greatest two-party preferred swing to an incumbent government since 1966. You will all, and to grasp the scale of what our party has achieved, we will remember the depths of political despair that many of us felt earlier this year. And the long battle back began months ago. And those who will seek to record wrongly that we only began to recover late in August forget the great turning point of the Aston by-election. Yeah. Mm. And the way in which our party and our National Party colleagues in coalition responded to the concerns of the Australian people in many areas. Can I record my gratitude to a number of people? I want to thank John Anderson, the leader of the National Party of Australia. There is no more decent man in the federal parliament, and his understanding of the concerns of country Australia is something that I value very much. I would also want to thank my colleague and friend, the deputy leader of the Liberal Party, Peter Costello.
As the nation dumps on Seven.
Yes, and a big, very big support group here for Peter Eath and Lindsay Tanner as they make their way onto the panel.
Very popular figures.
Incredibly popular.
Aren't they popular?
I mean, Nicole Kidman walked through a little while ago. No one better than Eileen.
Totally ignored.
In that. Thanks very much but indeed.
The caretaker Minister of Defence walks through.
Yes.
It's pandemonium.
And what's going to be interesting, should a couple of big ones go off tonight, you will be hearing return fire on the phone here tonight because
that's
we've
right.
got him. the caretaker Minister of Defence, right here on 7.
Is that true? If war was declared, like, you know, let's say it was, how would the chain of command work?
Peter, just take us through that.
Well, I would give you your instructions, I suppose.
Oh, okay.
And we'd put you into your uniform and send you off.
But we're still already...
And actually, I reckon we just sent the two of you to be enough.
But you've obviously got your people here, and the phone call would come through, what, from the PM or something like that. We're at war. And you'd be giving instructions, I suppose.
Just pick up the phone and show us how you do it. War is declared.
Is that you, John?
It's go green.
I need my orders so I can pass them on down the line.
Wouldn't New Guinea come in with us, do you think?
Well, we'd need all the help we'd get, wouldn't
bloody
we?
Bloody hell.
Because we'd be building a coalition.
Of course.
With Nauru at the front, yeah. Australia and New Guinea, probably
and
in that
New
order.
Zealand.
And New Zealand, let's not forget that. Now, we put an internet poll into the air a little while ago. Should corporal punishment be reintroduced into schools?
Yes.
This was a Mark Latham idea in Werriwa. And have a look at these figures. These are really interesting figures.
There's a blowing mind.
Yes. 71%. No. 29% there, so it looks like Monday morning, should the Labor Party get back in, be prepared, kids, if you are going to school, whack, whack, whack.
And well, I think that'd be a very popular issue.
Especially amongst teachers.
Amongst teachers, yeah.
Now, I understand we're going to... Oh, the next
internet
poll.
Ah, here it is, here it comes. Is John Howard a ladies' man?
Yes.
Yes, A or B, no.
If you've forgotten what John looks like, here he is with a number of ladies... snapped in the electorate last week. There he is there on screen. You can see really those three or four people with him there really think he's the business.
Getting off. And the number is i7news.com.au.
That's the site to go to register in the current poll concerning the ladies' man and the PM. And, of course, remember, emails, keep them coming. Now, the seat of low.
Yes.
The seat of low. We've got Johnny Murphy for the Labor Party there.
David Doust is up against him.
David Doust. There's some figures coming through now. And, whoa, both sides have got a big increase there. The vote's been polarised with a little bit going to the Democrats and the Greens.
Yeah.
And if we look at the two-party
preferred...
Big losses
to One Nation. Well, who'd want to vote One Nation? There's no need. They're irrelevant now.
Indeed. Looks like John Murphy may, in fact, hold that seat. Chris, you've got him on the dangle.
I have. John Murphy, thanks for joining us this evening. You must be feeling fairly optimistic at the moment.
Cautiously optimistic.
Side Ballarat, McHugh and Richmond are looking dicey for the government. OK, Fran.
Just on one, perhaps some good news for Nick. I was just speaking to...
Yes, the Prime Minister there accepting victory for the third time. It's getting on a bit here in the National Tally Room. Accepting victory for the third time there. And, Roy, I think we've got a chance to look at the final basic shape of the House in the Bums on Seats graphic. Take us through those big doors for the final time tonight.
Yes, let's have a look, HG. There's nothing so we can tell, and I think this would be accepted by both sides of the House at the moment, that the House will look, when the new Parliament sits, like this. Labor, 67 seats. Independents, 3. And the coalition, 80 seats, which is a clear and easy working majority for the coalition government.
Now, those figures were pretty well established several hours ago, weren't they?
Well, I think we established those very early on, HG.
Yes.
I think we had the technology, we were well ahead of our competitors, and it's been an enormous privilege to be able to bring the news of the new government to the Australian people. Before anyone else thought possible.
Yes, that's right. And your early prediction of Labor by 27 seats, do you feel a little bit silly now about that?
No, I feel I went out on a limb and you had to start somewhere. I think always you've got to start with a thesis.
Yes.
And then either go work through to prove or disprove it. That's how knowledge works.
Yes. And speaking of thesis, a man who's been with us all evening, the Field Marshal Malcolm McKerris. Can we have a final thought from you, Malcolm, tonight on the election?
Only how very similar the speech of John Howard was to the one of Paul Keating in 1993, except he didn't actually say this is the sweetest victory of all, but he more or less said that.
Can you just develop the point about 1993? Your theory is that 2001 is 1993, and therefore that in 2004 we will be back at 1996, is that...
Correct.
You understand?
Labor will have the sort of big win next time that the Liberals had in 1996.
And there's very little the government can do about it.
In my view, there is nothing the government can do about it.
So really, Kim Beazley should hang on for another 2 years and 4 months and he'd be laughing.
Well, but the point is, he has lost the unlosable election, and he who loses the unlosable election never gets another chance, and he has recognised that, unlike John Hewson, who foolishly tried to stay on.
Right.
Yes.
Well, wise counsel there.
Indeed, from Malcolm, a bloke who's been around civility for a long, long time. We come to the panel then. Thanks very much for that, Malcolm, tonight. Glenn, you know, you look back at it now and it really couldn't have turned out much other way, really, could it?
Well, I thought the most interesting thing about John Howard's speech was he admitted to the depths of despair earlier this year, which I thought was fascinating. I mean, he kept his top lip and his bottom lip together and he soldiered on. And look, you can't build a house without foundations. And whatever happened with the boat people and the war against terrorism, you have to say that in the early part of that year, he built those foundations with all those policy changes on petrol, beer excise, the business activity statement. So he did the hard yards, if I could put it in your sporting parlance.
That was in the period when he was listening.
Correct.
He was out listening.
And leaking.
Yeah.
We come to the panellists now. Lindsay Tanner, you've got to select a new leader. And by your account, there's certainly work to be done on the issues that you will present to the nation over the coming 3 years.
This is our third defeat in a row. We've seen a continuation of the long-term erosion of Labor's primary vote. We've got a lot of soul searching to do, HG. We've got a lot of thinking to do, and there's a big challenge there for Labor. But I have no doubt that as we've done in the past, we'll come back, we will rise to that challenge, we'll be back bigger and better than ever, and I have no doubt that we'll present a great opposition again, and we will put a lot of pressure on the government, and we will front up for the next election with a very big chance of forming a government.
It sounds as though if you follow the swinger meter from Mr. McKerris, you're in. You don't have to worry about a thing.
Well, that's probably the earliest anybody's ever called an election result, about 10 minutes after the previous one. But good luck to Malcolm.
And the swing,
sometimes it's right, sometimes not.
The swing is 4.9%.
That's
a pretty healthy swing.
Well, that's pretty reasonable, but I have no doubt that Labor will come back. Yeah. We've got some big challenges in front of us. We've got some real thinking to do about the fragmentation of our base and some of the issues that are facing this nation. We need creativity and imagination and trying to work through the issues in a more productive way than we have been able to do so far. I'm absolutely convinced we'll be able to do that and present a great challenge to the Liberals.
Thanks very much for Lindsay.
Peter, you've been a great plotter, a self-confessed plotter over the years. Yes. Will you continue to plot? Well, or are you going to put the plot plans
away?
The
plotting?
I'll tell you what, first thing I'm going to do is give the Red Face Award to Gary Morgan.
Yes!
And then I'm going to give it to Malcolm for next time, because I don't reckon he's got it right that time. And I just think it's great, the Labor Party, because they got 101 great excuses why they lost.
Yes.
And as long as they think that's the reason they lost, they'll never win again, you know. Yes. So good luck to them.
Are you going to miss it, though? Are you going to miss the plotting and the fun?
Of course I'll miss it. You know, I hate to go. It's great fun, especially when you win.
Yeah, no, I understand that. And, Chris, thanks very much for your efforts tonight. I'm just wondering, from your perspective, do you have an overview of the election result?
Well, I think it's going to be interesting from here on in to see, A, who the Labor leader is going to be, B, who John Howard's going to put in those key portfolios of health, finance and defence, the portfolio Mr. Reith's leaving, and C, if Mr. Howard's going to stick it out for 3 years. So it's so more interesting from here on in, I think.
There's fun for you ahead.
Absolutely.
And so on behalf of everybody who contributed tonight, many, many people made this election coverage possible. Can I thank our panellists? Steve Martin, Amanda Vanstone, Lindsay Tanner and Peter Reith, all of whom took a chance with us. Natasha Stott Despoja for dropping by, and of course the Brigadier down there in the pit, Malcolm McKerris, who got promoted to Field Marshal by the end of the night. I'd also like to thank Kylie Gillies, the i7 team, for keeping us in touch with you at home, and Ruz Technology, who were able to bring us the results from the AEC and do the handy work that we needed done on those figures as they came into the tally room here tonight. And everybody from 7 here and many departments at Channel 7 have been put together to make this coverage possible. I'd like to thank everybody, but especially as we sign off, to Chris and Glenn, who have helped us marry the light entertainment end of the coverage to the news department. Not an easy thing to do, but I hope it's been worth the result. And Roy, there's another one in the bag, bro.
Yes, it's been a great election. It was great to anchor at HG. It's been a great night, one I'll always remember. And I look forward to the next doing it next time in about 2 years, 4 months' time. We'll be back, the old team, shoulder to the wheel, and we'll see if Malcolm's right.
Thanks very much for that, Roy. Thanks very much for everybody. Good night, Australia, from the National Tally Room for the final time. And the nation has dumped.
You're nobody till somebody loves you. You're nobody till somebody cares.
Australia, and welcome to the National Tally Room in Canberra. Welcome to a night of decision. Welcome to a night of excitement.
But gold won't bring you happiness when you're growing old.
It's not good manners to sort of crow about that.
He was very relaxed and expansive, he said.
And now it's tremendous to introduce Seven's senior political analyst. Analyst.
What's going to be next? Panic-stricken, paranoid, and defensive? I'll just leave that hanging there. Have a look.
So find yourself somebody to love.
You pinged me.
He did seem to spend a lot of time with kids. I don't draw any inference from this, but he just seemed to lurk about play schools a lot. How much of a chick magnet is the big bloke? Look at this. Look at this.
This is a party.
Off their faces, having fun. Roy often suggests you just stand over a bit of paper and swing the night tools at the seats. I think it's a bit more scientific than that.
It's saying that the Howard government will be returned with an increased majority.
The world still is the same. You never change it.
I'm afraid for all of you, I have to concede defeat. We have lost this election.
Well, you're nobody till somebody loves you. So find yourself somebody to